four-team UFL premier season begins tonight. The Las Vegas Locos and the California Redwoods. Renowned coaches Dennis Green and Jim Fossil have their team stocked with some familiar faces, like Locos quarterback J.P. Losman, a first-round pick in 2004.
Nice job, man. What are you
getting? The Redwoods look to Corey Ross in a powerful running game to make their opening statement. Denny Green's troops are ready for action.
Redwoods on three. One, two, three. Redwoods.
First time in 37 years, professional football is back in Hartford, Connecticut. There'll be familiar names and faces here this afternoon. United Football League opener between Hartford and Sacramento. It's next on NESN.
On the Sacramento Mountain Lions, as we talked about earlier, must win for the 1-3 Mountain Lions. Huge game, the start of three straight at home for Florida. Looking back last week, Paul, we have talked it to death. I'm sure Denny Green has seen it to death about the six turnovers, but there was a huge bright spot that was like old times last week for Sacramento in the running game.
Corey Ross, ladies and gentlemen, is back. You know, the first three games he had a total of 83 yards rushing. In this football game, he averaged 8 yards a carry, and he gained 71 yards on the ground, and he also caught 10 passes. This guy is a great football player. He had one mishap, a hiccup in this entire game. He fumbled going into the end zone, almost going in the end zone. But you just look at what he did in that ball game. Here's a guy, he can't carry this football team. Culpepper's got to do some things. But if they can get the running game out of him that they got a week ago, Culpepper should do fine.
And as Dennis Green repeatedly pointed out to us yesterday when we're all sitting around talking to him, the team last year, when they were the California Redwoods, played a much better second half than the first half, and actually Ross was a better runner later in the season. He's hoping now at Sacramento everything will look like that. He knows it certainly has to get that way.
And so everybody just understands one of the biggest problems they have in this football league is offensive linemen. And if these guys block the way they blocked for him last week, look out, Florida.
All right, let's check in on the sideline once again. And Paul Crane. Paul, I hope you can hear us in what has to be the loudest public address system in the UFL.
What? No, it's all good. I can hear you just fine, Kenny. I'm here with the Tuskers Director of Business Management, Windsor Hall. And Windy, for your team, which played in a couple of different cities in the state last year but has now settled on Orlando, what are some of the challenges of having a team in a city that has so much to do?
Well, first of all, the challenge is the fact that we do get to play all our games here, so that's the great thing about it. But this is a tough town. There's a lot of entertainment products here. You've got a great university out here, has a great football program going for themselves. We've had to play on three Thursday nights, or will play on three Thursday nights. That's been a little difficult. But I tell you, we've done a lot of grassroots marketing. We got out into the community, made some relationships, and it's going to come over time. I think the big thing is people have seen this is the second year of this league. They know that it's committed to come back next year. And, of course, the recent announcement of Joe Theismann joining us as president and part owner has really created a lot of buzz in Orlando.
And that's a name people recognize. You referenced UCF here in Orlando, but the Notre Dame guys lent his name as president and part owner. So what are some of the things Joe Theismann's involvement you hope to see happen with this team?
Well, obviously, he's going to get a seat at the table now, where the Tuskers, you know, a startup with a young league. We got the Orlando Magic here. You got a lot of prominent players in the sports scene. But all of a sudden, we'll get a seat at the table. We'll get into those meetings, and that'll help a lot. Joe being able to call on CEOs around town and say, hey, guys, this helps the community. This is economic development, and actually get out with those people and say, hey, we need your help. You know, buy 100 season tickets, have a night out for the company. And I think, you know, a lot of people are going to take Joe's phone call.
Well, we wish you and Joe Theismann and the Tuskers the best of luck. Thank you.
Well, we appreciate it very much. Thank you.
One guy that needs no luck is Ron Kruk, who's always game ready. And we here at HDNet know that he delivers more hits than he receives, as we send it to him now on the other sideline.
Well, I appreciate that, Paul. There's no hotter topic in football right now than the NFL's decision to impose massive fines and suspensions to players who are delivering helmet-to-helmet blows. Sacramento head coach Denny Green has an interesting theory on why these hits are taking place so much. Coach Green told us yesterday he believes the smaller shoulder pads players are wearing are forcing them to make more tackles leading with their helmets. Now, today's shoulder pads are built for speed. They're very, very light and very, very light, no matter who's wearing them. All the players from offensive linemen to wide receivers are wearing this same type of shoulder pads. Gone are the days when the offensive linemen or defensive linemen had those massive, bulky shoulder pads. Now check this out. These are shoulder pads for an offensive lineman. Compare them to shoulder pads for a wide receiver. There's not much of a size difference, and really, there's no difference in the amount of padding. It's a very interesting take from Coach Green, because you just don't see as many players making tackles using the shoulder pads. I'm sure our all-pro Paul McGuire has a take on this subject as well.
Kenny? I like that. Yeah, Ron, it actually looks like it's wider, the receiver's pads. It reminds me of that great comic routine, my shoulder, my pads.
Let me tell you something, Ronnie. When I played 50 years ago, we put on all the padding we could possibly find, and then we rented some because they didn't give us enough. So these guys are crazy. If I had a chance to put the big shoulder pads on, I'm wearing them.
Yeah, good stuff, Ron. And we were talking about that. Denny Green brought it up. It made sense. You aren't seeing as many guys. He cited one of the greats in the secondary of all time, Ronnie Lott. So you're not seeing those hits with the shoulder and the chest like you used to. And that's why there's been some controversy about some helmet use, and not just in the NFL, but we've seen a few licks in the UFL.
Well, if you want to see them get rid of head-to-head contact, take the face mask off the helmet, because this thing is a weapon. They got that big face mask on, and they launch with it. You put that one bar or two bars on that helmet, you watch the number of guys that launch with their head. None. None.
All right. We're getting near kickoff. The music is pumped up. The girls are dancing. The Tuskers, Mountain Lions, are just minutes away.
HDNet Halloween. Raise hell with the premiere of Event to Metal.
Judas Priest. Megadeth.
Corn. Give a kiss with Wicked Lewis. It's HDNet's Heavy Metal Halloween. Hosted by Drilling Maze and Shane Lampley. Halloween night at 8. Only HDNet.
On an all-new episode of Drinking Made Easy, Zane and the boys make drinking easy in Dallas. First, Zane gets the wrong end of a buffalo.
You think this guy was grazing out in a field and said, hey, I'd love it if my ass was displayed in a bar?
Then kicks it like a cowboy. And Steve feels the wrath of 15 pounds of meat and potatoes.
How, my friends? Puking made easy.
Drinking Made Easy in Dallas. All new episode Wednesday at 8:30 Eastern on HDNet.
Ah, the moon has drifted up from Miami, obviously, and is now over Orlando as we are minutes away from the Tuskers hosting the Mountain Lions in UFL action here on HDNet. Kenny Rice and Paul McGuire, during your great career and even afterward, I know that you, as with so many of the pro football players involved in the community, with kids and some of those not able to help themselves and less fortunate, it's always been a big part of football and sports to give back.
It's one of the neatest things you'll see, and it's in all sports, not just professional, but college and high school. It's in all sports where you have an opportunity to go to see someone, sit down, in this case a hospital, where these kids just look up and they're in awe, and you can't imagine the lift that you give them by just your presence in the room. It is just, to me, it's the most wonderful thing these guys do.
It goes on with all five teams in the United Football League, and recently our cameras caught up with the Sacramento Mountain Lions on their Community Monday initiative when they took time out to visit the burn unit of the Shriners Hospital.
Oh.
What we have set up is we have dominoes,
pool, air hockey, basketball. The kids love to take pictures with new people, so whoever's up for that, I'd love to do that with some of the kids.
It means a lot to me, hopefully, just to see that, you know, these kids, you know, look up to us and, you know, see, and hopefully we brighten up their day by being here. And, you know, just doing that, it makes it worth it.
So, I mean, it's great, man, to come out, see the smiling faces, man, to see the smiling face on the kid and to compete against them, because this kid right here is a pretty good dominoes player. But it makes me feel good to be, you know, just a part of this, and, you know, it's a lot of fun. That's why I came back, because I knew I was going to have some competition in some of these games.
Lions football players are great sports, playing with the kids and making them laugh.
We love to do what we do. We love to, like, give back to the community because it's given so much to us. So this is kind of our way to do this.
Where else do you get to be over 300 pounds and play with Play-Doh, and it looks natural. It's fun.
Numbers on Dante Culpepper.
Kicking things off will be Nick Novak. Novak, who shares the record of 54 yards with Fabrizio Scaccia, both the kickers in here, they booted the long field goals. Novak lifts it high into this floor tonight, and taking it at the two is Woods. Yeah, it's across the 20, up to close to the 24, and that's where Sacramento will start. 23-yard kickoff return, just a little above his average, actually, for Aaron Woods. And here comes Dante Culpepper, the first time in a dozen years he has stepped on this field as a player. And, of course, a great career at Central Florida. He helped put that program on the map as they were making the move from mid-major up to major in the collegiate ranks. Corey Ross, the setback. He is their go-to guy, and they go to him for about 2 yards up the middle before Odell Thurman meets him and brings him down. And Ross, coming off his best game of the year, over 150-plus yards in total offense. Klutz is the man that blocks for him there at fullback, and that's mostly what Klutz does, is try to open things up. Tay Biddle is starting in place of the injured Rod Windsor. We may see him later on. That is huge. He's the leading receiver Windsor is on this team. You see the front line where Spano starts again at right guard. Second down. They flip it out quickly to Tay Biddle, the former Florida Tusker. Picks up a short gain as they were on him quickly, and that is Terrence Melton. Melton, along with Thurman and Schlegel, the guys playing at linebacker tonight. Chukwuera is one of the best in the league again in sacks. Big night, though, for Schlegel is expected because Tim McGargle, who is second on this team in tackles, is out. Their middle linebacker has a thumb injury, so he is on the sideline. Some changes as well in the secondary because of injuries. On third and about seven. Number 13 is Maxwell now out left. Culpepper looking in that direction, throwing complete to the tight end, Nate Lowry, coming out of the backfield and moving up was Tribble to make the tackle.
Boy, this is an outstanding play by Tribble. He has played corner, and you get the fullback coming out in the flat. Watch number 31. He's at the bottom of your screen. He just sees the tight end come out, bam. He's on him for no gain, basically. I mean, that's just an outstanding play by a corner.
It is three and out for Culpepper and company on their first, and so they will kick it away now, and Avian Kaysen stands back awaiting the kick of Tom Malone. Malone averaging 41 yards per punt. Kaysen right now is number one in the UFL in punt returns. And that is his role for the most part on this Florida team at this moment, as obviously Rhodes will start, and we expect to see Hicks, and we have a delay out on the field.
Well, they didn't have enough guys on the field. That's why there's a delay. And there were, I mean, why someone didn't run on the field? Now they've got a defensive back coming in the ball game.
EA Sports, I don't understand. To the game.
You know, when you change players and you go through special teams and you're always a block, and you go through the special teams of starters and then the backups, this is ridiculous, really.
And Kaysen moves up about 5 yards, standing around his own 29. It's high, it's short. Kaysen is going to let it bounce,
And it's going to drop right around the 37-yard line, so it will be good field position for the Florida Tuskers when they come back. Sacramento went three and out. How will Bollinger and company do?
Sure, we pick up the zone blitz. Weak side linebacker, who's got him? Who's got the Sam linebacker when he comes?
We
got
to pick this up now. Here we go. Flank right. F fly.
The United Football League. If you like great football, you'll love the UFL.
What pisses you off?
The hardest words are fighting words.
When I don't get my workout in, that pisses me off. What prepared you for this kind of combat sport? The way I grew up, being picked on a lot when I was younger. Can you go into a fight and not hate your opponent? I know I gotta do what I have to do. He's gonna try to hurt me. You still are doing those spinning back kicks. How the hell do you do that?
Fighting Words with Mike Straka. Tomorrow at 8:30 on HDNet.
You live and learn. You kick and you punch, you feel the pain.
A tournament with a generation of tradition is adding a new chapter and continues the journey for a new champion. K1 World Max 70 kilograms, Final 16. One will stand alone.
The time for Talkies Ivan.
On the channel with more MMA events than any other network. Don't miss a minute of action. HDNet Fights. K1 World Max 70 kilograms, Final 16. Tomorrow at 10 Eastern on HDNet. Your home for MMA.
The United Football League on HDNet is presented by Men's Warehouse, the official men's retail clothing store of the United Football League. Men's Warehouse. By AOL Fanhouse. For more information on the United Football League, go to fanhouse.com. By Progressive Insurance, making it easy to shop for car insurance. And it's a beautiful night here in Orlando, and we're at the Citrus Bowl, and for the first time, the Florida Tuskers come on the offense after holding Sacramento to a three and out, and they have good field position. They'll start at their own 37-yard line. Brooks Bollinger on the play fake. Rolling, looking, throwing, and has the completion up near midfield, and he goes to Hankton. There is a flag on the play. That's Cortez Hankton, who is the number one receiver on this team. It looks like it's going to go against Parker, Paul.
Yeah, number 90, Parker, is a defensive end, and he just grabs Bollinger after he throws the football. Roughing the passer, yeah. You know, here we are. We talked to Coach Green about this, and he said, you know, dumb penalties. And one of the things, look at this. Now, watch what happens. Bollinger throws the ball. Now, look at this. He doesn't, it's not head-to-head contact. The ball was thrown. He takes two more steps, he being Jason Parker, and knocks Bollinger down. That is dumb.
So an 11-yard pass to Hankton, and then tack on the 15 yards on top of that, and it moves the ball down to the 35-yard line of Sacramento. A huge way to get this game started. Posiak, the tight end, going over on the left side. They'll keep it on the ground and pick up some yards with Dominic Rhodes. First time we get to see Rhodes carry. And Josh Leonard moves in to make the tackle. There you see Bollinger. We talked about that record-setting game that Culpepper had the first time these teams met. Bollinger had 328 yards and a touchdown pass in that game. And already now he's gone over 1,000 yards with that 11-yard completion to Hankton. As it's second and four. On the reverse, that's Price. Maurice Price does not fool Sendejo. Andrew Sendejo, the strong safety, shoots in to make the hit.
Sendejo just lets you know now why he's a leading tackler on this football team.
And Sendejo carrying a lot of the weight because of injuries. We'll talk more about that. The speedster Russell, we've seen Hankton, their leading receiver, make a catch. Posiak is also a threat. And then you look along the front line there with Lucas being one of the veterans at the center position. Goddard is starting now because of some injuries, and Clark is also playing more. We'll talk about that later on third and six. Pressure, protection, throwing over the middle, has his completion to Stone. The backup tight end, Galen Stone, makes the catch, but picks up short yardage, and it's going to bring up a fourth down as Sendejo and Keys right there. And Jay Gruden now looking on as his team will try a field goal.
Yeah, well, they brought two, yeah, number zero.
I just think that, and I said it in the pregame show, that Bollinger's got to go downfield with the ball. There's just too many dinks and danking around. I mean, you've got a guy like Dominic Rhodes that you can fake to, should be able to throw the ball downfield.
48-yard attempt for Nick Novak out of the hold of the punter Parrish. He's got the leg, and he is right through it. Nick Novak is one of the best kickers in the league. He's 10 for 13 on the season. That 48-yarder puts the Tuskers on top 3-0.
Manhouse.com. Go beyond the scores and stats. Get the story behind the story from an all-star cast of writers who tell it like it is. Your sports live here. So step inside Manhouse.com.
HDNet Halloween. Race Hell. With the premiere of
Avenged Metal. Judas Priest. Megadeth. Corn.
Give them a kiss with Wicked Lyrics. It's HDNet's Heavy Metal Halloween. Hosted by Drilling Ladies and Zane Lamprey. Halloween night at 8. Only HDNet.
You better run to Men's Warehouse. Suits are on sale, including designer brands and big and tall. Buy one and get a second suit for just $100. You're gonna like the way you look, I guarantee it.
There was a major penalty in that last drive, a 15-yard personal foul against Sacramento, and so that helped Florida in five plays with 32 yards, and Nick Novak capped it off with a 48-yard field goal. We played less than 5 minutes into the game. It's 3-0. Tuskers lead as Novak tees it up, and Aaron Woods steps back. Woods with a 23-yard return the last time. And Sacramento gets ready to come on offense for the second time.
You know, Kenny, one of the things we're seeing in all the games that we're doing in the first quarters, especially, most of these offense, or all of these offense, are struggling. They pick it up a little bit in the second quarter, but in the second half, it's big.
Short kick taken around the 23-yard line and will be a run back by the up back for a very short gain. That's Schaible. Is that Schaible carrying the ball?
Well, yeah, I mean, you would just think that Schaible would, you know, put his hand up and call for a fair catch.
Well, he's had a sack this year and now a kick return, if that's right. A.J. Schaible will give him credit for it.
Well, he's supposed to be in the wedge.
Meanwhile, standing 20 yards back saying, hey, where's the ball? Is Aaron Woods. All right, on offense for the second time. They will start in pretty good field position at their own 28. That's Lowry, the tight end, moving over to the right side. Culpepper with the audible. Biddle still in, number 17, down at the bottom of your screen. Culpepper throwing, and Amy, it's going to be short and incomplete. That's Otis Amy, the intended receiver, who has 14 catches on the season, Melton out in the vicinity.
Dante Culpepper's got to, first of all, get the ball up. That ball's on the ground, there's no question about it. But he's got to get the ball up in the air so that these guys have a chance to run with it after they catch the ball. I mean, that play wouldn't have gone anywhere anyway.
Now he's 2 for 3 for 5 yards on the night. Played 5 minutes into the game, 3-0. Florida leads on 2nd and 10. Corey Ross goes in motion. Ross is their leading receiver on the season. Culpepper, a fumble, back up with it, throwing, complete. And he hits John David Washington out of the backfield. Washington making his 4th catch of the season.
Washington had to leave the game last week. He got dinged in the head. Wasn't a concussion now. He just got hit in the head. But John David Washington not only is a great utility back, but he's also a very good special teams player. And you know, you have no problem calling audibles here, you know.
No.
The crowd doesn't bother you, even if you're the visitors.
They pick up 6 on that. It's 3rd and 4. at the 36. Culpepper protection, stepping up, throwing, and it's incomplete, and that's Tribble there on defense. DeJuan Tribble just moving into the starting lineup. He does have an interception this season. They've had several injuries in that secondary.
Look where this pass is. It's behind the receiver. There is really no chance to catch the football. You've got to put the ball out in front of the receiver. He knows that. He's upset with himself. Dante is.
That was intended for Amy. So again, a very short series for Sacramento. Three and out again. And again, it's Tom Malone to kick it away. And Kaysen hoping to get a return this time. Steps up, takes it to 25, 30, up the middle. He's to the 40, gets it up to about the 44. There is a flag on the play. It's an 18-yard return there by Kaysen before Thomas, Dontarius Thomas, brought him down. Let's see what the flag is. It's back in the vicinity of the 35.
Illegal block in the back by the receiving team, number 50. Penalty is 10 yards from the spot of the foul. First down.
That's on Tony Taylor.
Number 50 is a block in the back. And I always, how many times do you hear me say, if you see his name, don't block it? Well, he saw his name and still blocked it.
Florida has the ball when we come back.
You better run to Men's Warehouse. Suits are on sale, including designer brands and big and tall. Buy one and get a second suit for just $100. You're going to like the way you look. I guarantee it.
Inside the 10, the 5, touchdown!
The first meeting was all Vegas.
There's nothing better than winning. Nothing better.
Omaha's dream season far from over.
We want to be that last team standing.
The push for postseason is on. Every game matters.
We're a physical team, and we're in good shape.
Every team is capable. Every single week is critical.
The UFL on HDNet, Las Vegas and Omaha. Coverage begins live next Thursday night, 7:30 Eastern, only on HDNet.
Hello, how are you?
Guys Night In is taking Thursdays off.
For once, we're gonna do something wholesome.
Sounds like it sucks.
This is messed up, okay?
Here's the problem. You don't have our friends nudity and our friend alcohol.
But don't stress. You can still watch us on Saturday nights.
It's heavy. My heart's going right now thinking about it.
Catch fresh new episodes November 4th.
See? See how it works? It's nice.
Guys Night In returns Thursday, November 4th.
The only thing weird in my mind is that date.
Only on HDNet.
FanHouse.com. Go beyond the scores and stats. Get the story behind the story from an all-star cast of writers who tell it like it is. Your sports live here. So step inside FanHouse.com.
And welcome back to the Citrus Bowl, the home team, Florida Tuskers. This is the first of three straight home games they have. Some big games coming up. They're 2-2 coming in. We think, and Jay Gruden has agreed, they can control their own destiny here. They have two of those games with Omaha. First one here, and then they close out the season going to Nebraska. Right now, they're just a game behind the first place Las Vegas Locos. As Florida comes out again, their second time, they drove down and were able to pick up a field goal the first time. They will stay on the ground early on, and it's Dominic Rhodes with his second carry of the night. And Josh Leonard makes the tackle.
You know, you keep giving the ball to Dominic Rhodes, and if Sacramento keeps playing eight guys basically up in the box to stop the run of Dominic Rhodes, that's when Bollinger's got to go downfield. And he's got the people that can get deep.
Hold Bollinger it, two for it, two. Biggest pass, an 11-yard pass out to Hankton early on. Bollinger play action. Sets, unloading deep down the sideline, and it is incomplete. He wanted to go to Price, the speedster. Ronnie Prude was right there with Maurice Price.
Bollinger just didn't get enough on this ball. You see Price now. I mean, he is at Prude's with him, number 21. Watch Price. Price has to wait. He has to come back, and Prude just puts himself in a great position so that the receiver couldn't get back to the ball.
You see across the front line, Schabel is taking the place. Actually, he moves over from tackle to end because Lewis Holmes is out. Josh Leonard moves into the starting rotation on that front line. And there's Thomas Marino and Taili Ely. They've been playing well. Bourne is out for the season with a broken leg. Terrell Mays steps in his place. We saw some good play from Mays last week. Bollinger, third and 10, throwing, trying to get the first down. He gets the completion. Coming out of the backfield is the fullback Runnels, but right there is Kelly Malvo, who comes up the backup at cornerback to quickly make the tackle and bring up a fourth down.
And the reason he throws this ball out to the fullback Runnels is because everybody downfield was covered. Just outstanding defense by the secondary.
No conversions yet on third down for either team, and it's time to kick it away, and Kim Parrish for the first time will boot it, averaging 41 yards a kick, and standing back is Aaron Woods.
Good kick.
That is high. Woods waits, takes it, and goes down, and the ball is loose. It's fumbled. It's picked up by Florida. Dacus comes up with it. It is Weston Dacus, the first-round draft pick out of the University of Arkansas. Well, he's the one that comes up with the loose ball.
This was supposed to be a reverse to Price, Kenny, and take a look at it. Excuse me. To Biddle, I mean, take a look at it. And Biddle never gets the ball because Woods never gets him the ball.
Keith Davis was right on top of that, the former Dallas Cowboy. He made the hit and caused the fumble, and then Weston Dacus just swarms on it.
Here's another mistake by Sacramento. We saw six of them last week, and they start out here in the first quarter with another one.
It can't get any better for Bollinger right now. Great field position here, first and 10 around the 23, except there's no, absolutely no place to go for Rhodes, and Keys is shooting right in there.
Well, you know, you've got safeties. They're sitting up at the line of scrimmage and just filling in. Keys is a safety, number 22, and that makes the play. You know, they're just not getting to the outside. If you're going to concentrate, I think, against Sacramento at the beginning of this game, try to run inside the tackles.
They lose a yard, second and 11 at the 24. Rhodes the lone setback for Bollinger. Pumps, throwing over the middle, intercepted. Intercepted by Sendejo. Sendejo to the 20, and he gets back to the 25. Huge play by Andrew Sendejo after the turnover by Sacramento. They force the turnover, and Bollinger is picked off.
Take a look at this where Bollinger throws the ball. Look at the white shirts down here, Kenny. There is no, the only one blue shirt is in the area. Bollinger throws the ball where there are four white shirts, and Sendejo is the guy that takes the ball. Look at this. There's just no chance for the receiver, Russell, to get to the ball. I don't care how fast you are. If there are four guys covering you, you can't catch it.
Sendejo, his first interception. He returns it back 24 yards. And now a golden opportunity blown here by Florida. Let's see what Dante Culpepper can do on his third offensive series, working from the 24. It's been a bit of an awkward start for Dante so far. Drops, sets, fires down the sideline, and it's knocked away. He and Castile is right there with great defense. He has had two interceptions this season. He got a glimpse of Sendejo. We've already seen him. Let's take a look at some defensive plays so far. There's Sendejo forcing that. Malvo there.
These guys, I'm going to tell you something, they're staying near the line of scrimmage. One of the reasons, because Bollinger is not throwing the ball deep. And when he did on that time, the safeties just read it perfectly and got downfield.
Second and 10, Corey Ross gets the pitch. Trying to find something, he may have picked up a yard.
I'm going to go back to something we've been saying for five games, and here we are in the sixth game, Kenny, and it hasn't changed. One of the biggest problems that the NFL has are the offensive linemen. You know, the National Football League, they don't give any of them up. They keep them. If they don't, they have them on a taxi squad. But the problem is these guys have only played together for 5 or 6 weeks. They really don't know each other. They're all from different teams, from different systems. And it's the hardest thing in the world to teach these coaches to work five guys as a unit.
Sacramento is yet to convert on third down, trying to avoid another three and out on third and 9, Culpepper. Deep drop, now the pressure's on, almost goes down, sheds a tackle, running, throwing, and does he have his completion to Maxwell? He's out of bounds. Maxwell out of bounds, and so it is three and out once again, and Roten was putting the pressure on Claude Roden, the former LSU star, was all over Culpepper as he released that.
Well, Dante escaped in the backfield, but then threw the ball wide.
Malone to kick it away. Kaysen waits back. Backs up at the 27. And spins up to about the 32-yard line. 5 yards on the return of the 48-yard punt. Florida's turn on offense.
Hi, this is Chaz Gessner, and you're watching the UFL on HDNet. No one gets you closer, period.
Hi, I'm Kenny Rice.
And I'm Buzz Rutten.
Be sure to join us each week for Inside MMA, bringing you a knockout panel of all-star fighters.
And as always, we take you places where only our cameras can go, and we give you news and highlights you won't find anywhere else.
Nowhere else. Inside MMA, tomorrow night at 9 Eastern, only on HDNet, your
home for MMA.
HDNet Halloween. Race to Hell. With the premiere of
Avenged Sevenfold.
Featuring Monsters of Metal.
Judas Priest. Megadeth. And Korn.
It's HDNet's Heavy Metal Halloween. Halloween night at 8. Only HDNet.
On an all-new episode of Drinking Made Easy, Zane and the boys make drinking easy in Dallas. First, Zane gets the wrong end of a buffalo.
You think this guy was grazing out in a field and said, hey, I'd love it if my ass was displayed in a bar.
Then kicks it like a cowboy. And Steve feels the wrath of 15 pounds of meat and potatoes.
How, my friends, is puking made easy.
Drinking Made Easy in Dallas. All-new episode Wednesday at 8:30 Eastern on HDNet.
Welcome back to Orlando, where the home team Tuskers have a 3-0 lead over the Mountain Lions. Sacramento's leading receiver in terms of yardage, Rod Windsor, he came into the game battling a hip injury. He was listed as doubtful, but he is dressed on the sidelines. I asked him, I said, Rod, are you going to see some time? He said, probably only in an emergency. Guys, they could use his explosiveness as he's the leader on the team with 3 touchdowns. Kenny, back upstairs.
Thanks, Ron.
Ron, it's an emergency.
I was going to say, get
in the game. It's an emergency.
He had 2 touchdowns, including the touchdown catch with about 30 seconds to go in the game to seal that comeback with 17 fourth quarter points. You see Culpepper and Windsor right there, number 8 to number 11. We've seen him hook up on 2 long passes this season, and Culpepper might be hoping somebody gets in there. He's 3 for 7 for only 12 yards as Brooks Bollinger. See how he shakes it off after throwing that interception at the goal line the last time. In motion is Hankton. Flag thrown. On the ground. Nice run. They pick up a first down for Dominic Rhodes, but is it going to be called back with the flag as Sendejo moved up to make the tackle?
They're not going to call it back. The defense is offside, and they're just going to accept the play because it is a first down.
Referee Chris Snead.
Offsides by the defense, number 93. That penalty is declined. It was all the play of the first down.
It's Fala Tuisi. Take a look at him. He just jumps up offside. But I like what the offensive line did for Florida. They just kept right on going.
Fala Tuisi, and we'll back up Shable now because Holmes is out. So we've seen a little bit of inexperience right there with that play. Good run by Rhodes. He'll try again. Rhodes already 4 carries, 17 yards. That's his 5th carry now as Thomas moves in to make the hit.
You think he's got, still has moves? Watch Dominic Rhodes, 33. Boom, watch this. Stop, left, now go left. That's quickness, folks, and balance. That is a beautiful run. He picked up 6 yards on the play.
Second and 4 at the moment. Rhodes has moved into the leading rusher in the league. Why not? He's doing about everything else. Came in here as the all-purpose leader and leader in touchdowns and rushing touchdowns with 4. Second and 4. Bollinger back. Throws it out quickly. Gets the first down to Hankton. And he gets a few more yards on top of that.
See what running the ball does, Kenny? It backs the corners off now because they figure you may have a chance to go deep. So look what Bollinger does. He goes back out here to the outside, and that's just a perfect throw to Hankton. you know, and there's not much you can do. Prude hasn't got a chance because he's got to worry about him going deep. Give him a little yardage, and it ends up a first down for Florida.
They move the ball down to the 37 after a 13-yard pickup, first and 10. Bollinger back on the ground. Inside the 30 and close to a first down is Dominic Rhodes again. Remember at the start of the season, that's Jason Stewart there making the tackle, by the way. Remember, Paul, at the start of the season, it's kind of like the three-headed monster perhaps it was going to be, with Avian Kaysen actually starting in place of Rhodes, and then Maurice Hicks there, and then Dominic Rhodes alternating maybe those three, and it's been all Rhodes since about week two.
But the thing about it is now he's getting blocking all along the line of scrimmage. They just tested the inside of Sacramento's defense a couple of times. Now they can get him at the tackle and to the outside.
Six carries, 33 yards. Here's his seventh carry, and Rhodes picks up the first down going over the right side. Dontarius Thomas makes the tackle from the outside linebacking spot, and he gets the ball down to around the 22, first and 10.
And Bollinger looked at the sidelines, and he kept moved his arm in motion. Let's go, let's go, let's go. Let's speed this up a little bit so they don't have a chance to get set. But we have a man down on defense.
And that is Zeke Marino, the middle linebacker out of Southern California, former Charger, former Eagle, who has played well, has an interception this season. He has been one of the anchors on the defense.
They say he's been playing as well as any of their linebackers, Marino is. And you know, you lose a guy in the middle, he's your signal caller. Take a look at this block, and there's Marino 57 now. He's stepping, and it looks like, ooh, he twisted his left ankle.
Yeah. And there is Marino going out. They already have Robert Bourne out for the season with a broken leg, who their outstanding corner. And Mays and Malvo are alternating there and picking up the slack. And now Marino goes to the sideline. Dennis Green, I'm sure, hoping this is just a temporary stop. They need this guy. First and 10 at the 22. Bollinger 4 for 6 with an interception. We've seen him underthrow the ball on a couple of occasions, including that interception. James Devlin is in at fullback. There is a play fake. Rolling, pumping, throwing inside the 10. He has his completion. He goes to Gessner. Chaz Gessner, 6'5 out of Brown, played last year with him.
Gessner, Kenny, is coming all the way across the field. They grab him coming through the middle. But Bollinger was going to throw the ball short, and then he saw Gessner break into the clear and threw him the ball. This just heads up by the quarterback.
Gessner had some shoulder problems last year, played about half the season. He picks up his seventh catch of this season, and it's first and goal down to the 6. On the ground, Rhodes. He's already scored 4 rushing touchdowns this season, has 5 overall.
When you let Rhodes get a start and pick up 3 to 4 yards every time he carries the ball, look out, because it sets up Florida's entire offense. Remember, Gruden was a quarterback in the Arena League, so he knows what needs to be done. Play action, you know, he just loves to have a quarterback fake and then get the ball deep. Here it doesn't have to go very deep, about 6 yards.
8th play of this drive. Second and goal. On the ground they go, and into the end zone. Once again, it's Dominic Rhodes for his 5th rushing touchdown of this season, adding to his league-leading total.
All Dominic has to say is that this is way, way, way too easy. Look at this. I mean, he really doesn't get touched or hit until he's 2 yards into the end zone. That's easy.
Rhodes capping off a long drive that ate up a bunch of clock, and Florida gets into the end zone. And Novak will tack it on. And it's 10-0 in favor of Florida. We have a flag. Let's see what this is about.
Illegal formation
by the defense. Number 93 was lined up over the center. That penalty will be enforced on the kickoff.
That was an 8-play, 68-yard drive, eating up almost 4 minutes of clock, capped by Rhodes going in for the touchdown. Let's go down to Paul.
Thank you, Kenny. Here with Dominic Rhodes. It took a while for the offense to get it going. What made it happen the way it did on this drive?
Well, I just think that we ran the ball a little bit more, try to control the line of scrimmage. And our guys are, you know, they've got me in major push. I'm just being patient and hitting holes.
Well, you're coming off the first 100-yard game of the season, 103 yards against Hartford 2 weeks ago. What's making the big difference in the run game now?
Like I said, the offensive line is coming off the ball, getting major push. I'm just being patient and hitting the holes, and it's working out for us, you know. It's just a major blessing right now.
Congratulations, Kenny. Nine touchdowns a year ago with the Indianapolis Colts. He may blow past that in the shortened season this year.
Thanks, Paul. Impressive. Dominic Rhodes, certainly the MVP contender right now in the league, along with Dede Dorsey out in Las Vegas, you would guess. As Dennis Green's hoping there's some kind of counter for this. He doesn't want to fall too far behind. That has been the problem all season long with this team. As Novak gets ready to kick it off. Rhodes, by the way, 9 carries, 44 yards already, capping it off with that touchdown. Woods takes it at the goal line. The 20, 25, nice run to around the 29-yard line for Aaron Woods.
This is a nice run because in the UFL and also in the National Football League, you can't form a wedge with more than two people. Just take a look at the four guys back in the back. Now, two of them come together, they hold hands. But right away, unless the ball carrier Woods is up close to them, they have to separate because they're seeing black shirts in front of them. There are no kickoff returns in this league so far this year for a touchdown, and that is one of the reasons why.
1:25 to go here in the first quarter. Fourth time that the Mountain Lions have been on offense. They're looking for their first down. Corey Ross finds the going tough over on the right side. Gets maybe a couple of yards before being brought down.
Dante Culpepper has thrown one ball deep, just one. And now you're asking Corey Ross to pick up yardage when the offensive line, they are struggling. There's no question about it. But if you look at Florida, they don't line up. You cannot line up eight guys on the line of scrimmage. But look at the number of guys that will be up near the line of scrimmage.
Culpepper, 3 for 7, 12 yards. Ross, the lone setback. That's Lowry in motion. Play fake. Culpepper sets. Nice little screen to Lowry. Trying for positive yardage. Gets about 3 or 4 on that before Thurman moves over. And Melton also bringing him down.
You know, if I'm going to run a screen pass, there are a couple of guys that I'm blocking, make sure. And Melton and Odell Thurman are the two linebackers that I make sure I block. Because if you don't, they're going to stuff it.
5 yards on that. It's going to bring up a 3rd and 2, and the first quarter is coming to an end. Well, Dante Culpepper's yet to pick up a first down. We'll see if that can change. Meanwhile, he's been the man all season. Dominic Rhodes going in for his 5th rushing touchdown. 10-0 Florida.
This stuff is good.
Breaking open the crust, it was like a treasure.
I think it's kind of the zest to it. Have you tried this?
I love them. This is really good.
That's good.
This is the real deal. This is the stuff that we eat.
I absolutely love Crunch and Munch.
My whole family loves Hebrew National.
I love Peter Pan.
I absolutely love.
They love it.
My son's love it.
I love.
My kids love it.
Oh, I love.
I love.
My family's love it.
I love.
Hi, I'm looking to save money on my car insurance. How do I know if I'm getting a good deal?
You should talk to the specialist.
The specialist?
He compares rates side by side. You could save hundreds. It's easy.
Great.
Okay, Pickles. Do your thing. Well, that's amazing.
I trained him myself.
I meant the... Okay.
Same coverage, more savings. Now that's Progressive. Call or click today.
I love the smell of napalm in the morning.
Ah!
get in! Enough!
Travel the globe, master the styles. The world of MMA has never been bigger. Rated T14, EA Sports. It's in a game.
This November, HDNet Sunday Concerts delivers a star-studded audio avalanche.
Steve Miller Band,
Cheap Trick,
and
Hit on a Run.
John Anderson and the Contemporary Youth Orchestra.
HDNet Sunday Concerts this November.
The United Football League on HDNet is presented by ConAgra Foods, maker of the food you love, and by Rydell. And it's a gorgeous evening here in Orlando, Florida. Temperature still around 78 degrees as we start the second quarter. And Sacramento looking for their first down of this game. Amy goes in motion on third and two. Dante Culpepper back, throwing deep down the sideline, and it's incomplete, broken up. That's Cletus Gordon, who is new to the secondary, making the defensive play.
Well, I tell you, Cletus Gordon, I mean, they just added this guy, number 21. And look at the play he's making. Now, I'm going to tell you, if he does not touch the ball, he did not turn his head, but the deal that he did is he touched the ball before the ball got there. Otherwise, it had been pass interference.
He was going for Tay Biddle. Good defense, and now taking a fair catch is Kaysen. And once again, Sacramento, three and out. Four offensive series, they have yet to come up with their first down. Tom Malone's getting to work out, the punter booting that 44 yards, and Kaysen taking the fair catch. As you look at Bollinger, Jake Rudin was telling us yesterday one thing that Bollinger, he's hoping will realize he's got much more speed this year. He had a solid recruiting receiving core last year, but he didn't have the burners as he has in Calvin Russell and Maurice Price, and even to an extent Hankton, guys that can just flat out fly.
And you look at Bollinger for throwing over 1,000 yards so far this season. He really hasn't gone deep like he should. We saw it one time, Calvin Russell, in the first game we did.
Against Vegas, he had that 68-yard touchdown. And there's Rhodes again, just continuing to grind it out. That's his 10th carry. He has 48 yards.
Well, the thing about it is, though, when you have a guy like Rhodes running the ball, you have Hicks, Maurice Hicks. We have not seen him yet. Kaysen back there. I mean, if you can run the ball as well as they're running the ball, we saw that with Vegas, how well they run it. You don't have to throw.
Second and six. That's what all the coaches tell us about. You want to get those manageable situations. And going right up the middle and fighting close to that first down once again is Rhodes. Ta'ili Ely leading the way and pushing him back.
Now you got third down at about a yard and a half. You see Rhodes just sit there and he waits and he waits and he waits.
Sure that Sacramento's happy to see number 57 moving in over there too. Zach Marino back in the lineup after walking off what looked to be maybe just maybe flipped his ankle or something. He's back in. He looks good. That's good news for them. Here it is, third short yardage and a completion for a first down. Nice little rollout and throwing and hitting Jermaine Wiggins, who has been alternating as the starting tight end with Posiak this season.
You know how easy this is. Watch this. Because of the fake, because of the running, he fakes to Dominic Rhodes. Now look at Wiggins on the outside. That's a safety that was trying to cover him, number 22, Dennis Keys. He just let him go. Because of the fake inside, it got Keys inside. Wiggins gets to the outside. That's almost like a run play.
There he is, 6'2", 270 pounds. He is a brute, Wiggins, of course, a veteran of the NFL. Played with the Vikings, had some good seasons. Picked up a Super Bowl ring with the Patriots. And there's a flag on first and 10. And we'll wait and see. It looks like there's movement over there on the Sacramento side.
I love it when a defensive guy's offside.
For the play. Encroachment by the defense, number 98. The 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
That's Burton, but when the defensive guy does that, Kenny, then he points to the offense. I didn't do it. I didn't do it. It's like you didn't get caught.
It's like kids on the playground. He made me. He made me. First and five. There's a look at Burton. You know, it's almost like musical chairs again with Lewis Holmes, the starting right end, out with a hamstring injury tonight for Dennis Green's team. They've had to move a lot of guys around, including Burton playing backup roles. They'll go on the ground again. Marino makes the tackle on Rhodes.
Marino's hurt. I mean, he twisted his left ankle. He's coming off the field. He makes the tackle, but to be a linebacker, a middle linebacker, where you really have to move laterally and you depend on your ankles, you really do. They all do. Come on, when you're running. But the thing about it is, Marino, he's got to come back and make the play, and he goes right down. He just turns the ankle again. I love his courage.
So he came back in. We'll see what this is as he goes back out limping if he gets back in the lineup. They swing it out quickly and pick up the first down and maybe get about another yard before Ronnie Prude moves in to make the tackle on Calvin Russell. Russell hauling it in for his ninth catch of the season.
And everything so far that Florida Tuskers have done with Bollinger is safe. I mean, they're running the ball very well with Dominic Rhodes. They're throwing short passes that are almost like handoffs.
4 yard pickup there makes it first and 10 at the 49 of Florida.
Look at Bollinger. I mean, he's 7 of 9, 56 yards.
There you see, Paul, just like you said, rather methodical. Florida averaging about 5 yards. Each play fake, Bollinger sets up, tries to unload, pressure on, he's going to go down. Nowhere to go that time, he could not get away. Too many guys around, Jason Stewart among those in there. Stewart already has one sack this season.
You know, they had three guys downfield, and Bollinger's looking, it's a play action pass, it really doesn't fool anybody, and then Bollinger tries to get away, which he does not. Moncourt, number 94, was a guy that got his hand on him to slow him down. But you know that the tackle was made by Stewart, and he's hurt.
11th time they have gotten to Bollinger this season as they work on him a bit. And you see Adrian Clark, the right guard, Brinsley there, number 63. Gryson. Maybe coming in, Chris Gryson. We have not seen him this season.
Bollinger goes off the field. All right, here's Bollinger. He just goes down to a knee. I mean.
So we'll wait and see there. And there he is, number 14, Chris Gryson. The quick update on him, 6'3", 220, you see. Out of Northwest Missouri State, has experience playing in the Arena League, where he's had success there. And of course, Jay Gruden knows quite a bit about the Arena League as a guy who's won championships as a quarterback and as a coach.
Gryson gets in a huddle. Come on, boys. All right, let's keep running the ball well.
Let's keep running it. I'll make a few short passes. We'll see if we can get it going.
Well, Bollinger's back up.
Well, that's the good news. He's moving around. He's got the ball.
I wonder if he just got the wind knocked out of him and he just got himself out of the game for one play.
Second and 15, ball back to the 44 for Chris Gryson.
Look at this, he's throwing.
Gryson comes up firing, incomplete. The helmet goes flying as he was shooting and intended for Hankton, and that was Dennis Keyes, who was right on top of Cortez Hankton.
I'll tell you, Dennis Keyes is playing a super game from that safety position. And Hankton's just trying to get inside. Watch Keyes, he reads it perfectly, bang! And the hit is right there. That's a great hit.
And Bollinger now coming back into the lineup. After one play, Gryson goes up.
I love Gryson. Gives in, hey, I'm throwing. I don't care what you're calling, I'm throwing.
I may not get back in for a while. That's right. Third and 15 now for Bollinger. Florida 1 for 3 on third down. Bollinger sets under pressure, unloading, and it's well incomplete. As once again, it was Jason Parker putting the heat on and getting a piece of that football. That's why it looked like a lame duck going down the field there.
I was just wondering, where did that come from? And Jason Parker came from the backside. I mean, that was just a nice play by the defensive line.
Good defensive possession, good position there for the defense with Stewart and Parker. We've seen Keyes and Sendejo. They made some terrific plays so far. Punt back for Woods. Woods across the 20, 25, 30 to about the 35-yard line, and there is another flag.
Back on the 20, they're going to bring this back, a block in the back, and it goes back to the 10.
So what would have been a 29-yard return for Woods on that 50-yard kick is going to be backing up in all likelihood. And once again, what you say, when you see the name, don't make the get.
During the return, illegal block in the back by the receiving team, number 26. The 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. It'll be first down.
That's Steve Baylark, the backup running back. That negates what was an excellent run by Aaron Woods. Can Sacramento get something going? They're on offense when we come back.
Greetings, America. If you wear UFL gear, you'll never look this good. Most of us will never look this good. But if you wear UFL gear, you're gonna look good.
UFL jerseys, caps, tees, and more are available now. Go to buyufl.com. The United Football League. If you like great football, you'll love the UFL.
It's been 6 years since they arrived. They are no longer aliens. They are residents. Scoot McNairy. Whitney Able, in a film by Gareth Edwards. Magnolia Pictures presents... Monsters. Monsters premieres in theaters Friday, October 29th. Can't wait? Now there are two ways you can watch it in your own home before it hits theaters. Order it now, on demand or pay-per-view, or watch it on HDNet Movies, Wednesday, October 27th. To get HDNet Movies, call your provider and order today.
Welcome back to the UFL on HDNet. The first quarter blues continue to haunt the Sacramento Mountain Lions. This marks the fifth straight game the team has failed to put points on the board in the opening quarter. They've been outscored 26-0. Guys, it's the slow start Denny Green has been talking about.
Indeed he has. Thanks, Ron. And that's why he says we haven't been able to get the running game going because we're always behind. You know, it's 6-1, half a dozen or the other. It's a tough situation to be 1-3 and already down 10-0 on the road here in Florida.
But as bad as they're playing, they're only down 10 points. I mean, this is what Denny Green, it just drives him crazy. We're not playing all that bad. We just can't get much going on the offensive end of it.
Culpepper with the long field because of that penalty on the punt return, and he runs with Ross up the middle to get a short gain. So far, Florida has had the ball almost 6 full minutes longer. Sometimes that can be misleading, but they have been grinding it out. They got a field goal, they got a touchdown.
You know, I always think about time of possession. For as many years I've been doing it, doesn't mean a thing. What time of possession mean, what did you do with that time? You know, these guys have done nothing with the time.
Florida has done something with their time tonight. They actually had a couple of long drives, one resulting in a touchdown. They'll swing out the screen and see if Ross can do the work after that, as he usually does, and that's Odell Thurman running him down from behind.
Odell Thurman is a leading tackler on this Florida team, and he's a linebacker, and they usually are. Odell Thurman, I mean, don't let him get a great shot at you because he's going to nail you. Odell Thurman, this is a screen pass to the outside to Russ. They're trying to get it to him in any way they can. And there's Odell Thurman coming from behind and making the tackle. You're not going to outrun him.
Third and three at the 17. They've yet to convert on third down.
Oh, holding.
Culpepper moving, throwing, tipped. Falls, fortunately for them, incomplete. Castile there getting a hand on it, and I'm sure there was a collective sigh on the sideline after the turnovers last week. They don't want an interception down this close to the goal line.
I saw two holding penalties on the play, right? First, on the left of your screen, there was a holding penalty by Llewellyn, and then Culpepper throws the ball, but there was another holding penalty in the middle of the line. That's just excellent coverage.
For the fifth straight time, it's three and out, and Malone for the fifth straight time kicks it away. Casey steps back, sheds a tackle at the 40, gets to about the 42-yard line before being brought down. 6-yard return after a 47-yard punt. Florida's turn when we return.
Pisses you off.
The hardest words are fighting words.
When I don't get my workout in, that pisses me off.
What prepared you for this kind of combat sport?
The way I grew up, being picked on a lot when I was younger.
Can you go into a fight and not hate your opponent?
I know I gotta do what I have to do. He's gonna try to hurt me.
You still are doing those spinning back kicks. How the hell do you do that?
Fighting Words with Mike Straka. Tomorrow at 8:30 on HDNet.
You live and learn. You kick and you punch, you feel the pain.
A tournament with a generation of tradition is adding a new chapter and continues the journey for a new champion. K1 World Max 70 kilograms, Final 16. One will stand alone.
The time for talk is Ivan.
On the channel with more MMA events than any other network. Don't miss a minute of action. HDNet Fights. K1 World Max 70 kilograms, Final 16. Tomorrow at 10 Eastern on HDNet. Your home for MMA.
Inside the 10, the 5, touchdown!
The first meeting was all Vegas.
There's nothing better than winning. Nothing better.
Omaha's dream season far from over.
We want to be that last team standing.
The push for postseason is on. Every game matters.
We're a physical team, and we're in good shape.
Every team is capable. Every single week is critical.
The UFL on HDNet, Las Vegas and Omaha. Coverage begins live next Thursday night, 7:30 Eastern, only on HDNet.
Just as we rehearsed it. Welcome back to the Citrus Bowl. Florida leads it 10-0. Brooks Bollinger and company coming back on the attack. It's just been three and out, three and out, three and out all night long for Sacramento. Tom Malone on his way to setting some kind of UFL punting record. We're still checking on that.
I remember one year in the 60s when I punted for the Buffalo Bills over 100 times in one season. There were only 12.
How many games did you play?
Not many. We had a bad team, man.
First and 10, they start the 42, good field position, and they start on the ground again because that is where their strength has been throughout this game. And it's Dominic Rhodes, of course, once again. What a workhorse he has been. And that's Ronnie Prude coming up to make the tackle. 13 carries, 61 yards for Rhodes, who's also added to his league-leading touchdown total tonight.
One of the things about Rhodes, when you watch him, he really trusts his offensive line. I mean, he goes to the hole and he hits it. And on that play, he picked up 4 yards. Now again, their offense, they can do whatever they want on second down.
Twice we've seen him limp to the sideline. Middle linebacker Zeke Marino is back in. Bollinger throwing deep down the side. And it is tipped away. And it's Sendejo coming over at the last moment. Mays was back there with Russell. And Sendejo making another exceptional play on defense.
Well, first of all, Russell has to wait. This ball just hangs in the air. Look at this. Russell is gone. But he has to wait and come back. Sendejo, number 34, is their leading tackler on the Sacramento team. He makes a play because the ball just hung.
And what's the thing again? We go back to what Jay Gruden was telling us about Bollinger. He's told him to release it quicker. Understand the speed he has in a guy that does a 4-3 like Calvin Russell. He's never had this kind of burner before.
When you have guys like Russell and Price, 17 and 88, throw it. Let him out run the ball.
Third and 6. Let's see what he does here. Firing it over the middle. Knocked down. Incomplete. Malvo, the veteran of the Canadian Football League and a couple of other leagues in there, moving up to make the hit. The former Arizona star knocking it down and forcing a fourth down for Florida.
I'm not making excuses, folks, but I'm going to tell you something. These are the worst jerseys I've ever seen. You can't tell who the guys are playing from the vantage point that we have. You can see it on the screen when we go up close, but looking out here, we have no idea.
Standing back to kick, Ken Parrish. And waiting to return it is Aaron Woods. Woods calls fair catch at the 15, will let it roll. And this is going to be good for Florida. They're going to down it around the 2-yard line. It appears that's exactly where it will be. Nice job by Ryan Sensor, the long snapper, who moves in there to nail it down at the 2. 52-yard punt. Dante Culpepper's going to have a long field to work with.
Manhouse.com. Go beyond the scores and stats. Get the story behind the story from an all-star cast of writers who tell it like it is. Your sports live here. So step inside Manhouse.com.
I'm Andre Dixon, running back from the Hartford Colonials.
What a hit. He dives in for the score.
I go to UFL-football.com for team news, player profiles, apparel, stats, and anything else UFL related.
Visit UFL-football.com for the latest information on your favorite UFL players. The United Football League. If you like great football, you'll love the UFL.
HDNet Halloween. Race Hell. With the premiere of
Avenged Sevenfold.
Featuring Monsters of Metal.
Judas Priest. Megadeth. And Korn.
It's HDNet's Heavy Metal Halloween. Halloween night at 8. Only HDNet.
You better run to Men's Warehouse. Suits are on sale, including designer brands and big and tall. Buy one and get a second suit for just $100. You're gonna like the way you look, I guarantee it.
Just under 8 minutes to go here in the first half. It's 10-0. Florida leading the Mountain Lions. It's been a tough night for Sacramento star Corey Ross.
Well, you know, we talked to Coach Gruden yesterday. Coach Gruden says the one guy we have to stop is Corey Ross. All right, they've done that. They've stopped Corey Ross. Now, yes, Steve Baylark, number 26 back there, he's averaging 7.9 yards a carry. Put the guy in. Maybe a change might help.
There you see the numbers on Ross last week, over 150 combined yards with his running and catching. You know, last week was the first time since October 22nd of 2006 that a Dennis Green team did not score a touchdown in a game. That was when Green was the coach of the Arizona Cardinals and they lost to the Oakland Raiders. Well, now it's moved on to the fifth and now into the sixth quarter without a score by Dennis Green's team. And they got a long field to work starting at their own three, and Ross probably lost about a yard there.
Well, there's a helmet from a lineman that went, 15 yards.
Yeah, Hernandez Jones shooting in there to make the hit, the free safety, it looked like.
Well, that was one of the longest gains of all, was the helmet.
The helmet went, the helmet picked up 6 on the play. Unfortunately for Sacramento, they picked up 0 on the play. There's a good look, clutch the fullback, and Ross stays in at tailback. Look how deep he is in the end zone. Remember, they've had one safety this year. That was in the Omaha game. On play action, just firing it out wisely, incomplete.
You know, this thing didn't fake out anybody. I'm telling you, this was unbelievable. Chuck, we're at number 56. I would believe it was him that was in the backfield. I can't tell because I can't change tick the number. But anyway, Culpepper did this one in one other game where he went out of the end zone just trying to throw the ball away. That bootleg pass in the end zone doesn't fake anybody out because the defensive end are told, you go up the field, contain your side of the field, and everything good will happen. And on that play, it all was good for the defense.
Rod Windsor, number 11, comes in for the first time. He is out wide to the right, the leading receiver on the team. He's had trouble with the hip flexor, but he's playing right now. On a play fake, Culpepper sets up, fires over the middle, has his first down to Windsor at the 18-yard line. That's how valuable Windsor can be, catching it right in front of Kiwan Ratcliffe.
Boy, I tell you, isn't that a nice play? Look at Windsor now. He knows where to sit down. He's your leading receiver. Watch this. Sits down. They're playing a zone defense on this guy. They didn't play him man-to-man. Until he came in the game, they were playing everybody man up.
And their first down conversion tonight, that 16-yard pass, Culpepper to Windsor. Some breathing room out to the 19. Joe West in, bottom of your screen, wide. Culpepper again, fires it the other way to Lowry, the tight end, and he gets close to a first down before being brought down by Anthony Schlegel, the man now starting in place of the injured Tim McCargle.
Isn't it neat when a guy comes in and jump starts your football team? Rod Windsor, number 11, comes in. He's got 17 catches, 3 touchdowns, and he comes in, and you know they're going to throw the ball to him, yet they don't cover him.
Two first downs in a row. They pick up 10 on the nose on that. First and 10 at the 30. Now they'll try to see if they can get a running game going. Ross gets a couple sliding over on the left side. That's Odell Thurman, number 52. Ron Kruk told us on the sideline earlier, they said emergency, they were probably going to get Windsor in. Well, when it's third and 10, you're backed up at your own three. That's an emergency.
That's an emergency.
Windsor came through for them.
Oh, man.
Well, some excitement with two first downs in this series. The best drive of the night for Sacramento on second and 9. Throwing to Lowry, complete, and a first down again as he gets up to about the 43-yard line. And there's Slagle again, the middle linebacker. Dante Culpepper may be feeling a little more like home now when he was a star here at Central Florida playing in the Citrus Bowl.
Well, Lowry's only has three catches going into this game. In the last three plays, he's caught the ball twice for first downs.
He's had four catches on the evening so far. Ross from behind, he probably lost a yard. That's Thurman. Odell Thurman, he is everywhere.
He really is. I mean, it's just, when you watch him, he just sees it all. And he's got enough speed to get to where he needs to get.
Second and 10 at the 43. This is the eighth play of the drive. We talked earlier about time of possession can be a little misleading, but this is some time that's turning into positive now for Sacramento. Culpepper looking, still looking. He'll go to the safety valve that is Corey Ross. And Ross will scoot up to about the 50-yard line and bring up a manageable third down. And Slagle's there for the tackle.
Kenny, this is unbelievable. Both sides of the defensive line red screen. Watch this. You see, look it on the left and then look it on the right. They both red screens, except the inside guy overruns the ball.
It's third and 5, ball at the 48. Working with the no huddle. Culpepper trying to keep a rhythm going. This has been a so far solid drive for him. Third down, guns it. First down to the 40, hitting Joe West. In front of Castile making the catch.
You know, Florida had it everything going their way. Now watch West, now he's working on the outside. You just watch him run. And the thing about it is, don't let this team get back in the ball game. You had him down 10, you had him down at the goal line, and you let him out.
First catch of the night for West, his seventh of the year. First and 10 at the 39. This is John David Washington inside the 30, about the 28-yard line. Slagle brings him down. We've seen Washington make a catch out of the backfield and now make a nice run. Remember, he had a good 10-yard run last week, and then he got shaken up a little bit, had a slight head injury and had to go out.
Well, and you know, when you watch John David Washington, he's getting to the outside. He broke it. They were expecting him to run more inside than outside.
11 yards on that. And strange position tonight for Sacramento. They're in Tusker territory at the 29. This drive still going. They swing it out to Tay Biddle. Biddle inside the 20, the 15, before being forced out of bounds. Tay Biddle, the former Tusker, who was one of the top receivers last year in the UFL, led the league in yardage.
This is a nice pass play, because what you have is you have two receivers, a tight end and a wide receiver out blocking, and your third wide receiver, which is Tay Biddle, number 17, catching a football. It's like a screen to the wide receiver.
They pick up 15. It's now first and 10 at the 14. Great drive going. Culpepper the other way. Pressure steps up. Vintage Culpepper. He got a hit in, lowers the shoulder, made some positive yardage. Castile felt a little bit of the thunder there of Dante Culpepper.
I'll tell you what, Dante Culpepper just showed you he still has some speed. He looks like he's going to get tackled in the backfield and then outruns the linebacker. Dante Culpepper says, give me the play.
Second and 2 after Culpepper picks up 8. Look at this drive. This is the 13th play of the drive. Second and 2 at the 6.
And on a third and long to Rod Windsor, started the whole thing.
And remember, that was back at their own 3-yard line. Culpepper looking in zone, and he's throwing this one out. Amy was not even in the vicinity. He was one going in that fade and had good coverage.
At Windsor, he had, Culpepper had him short. Now, you got to remember, Windsor, number 11, has been nursing a bad hip. So he's only, they can only spot play him.
It's a third and two. Sacramento picking up all their first downs in this drive. They're 2 for 7 on the night on third and two. Culpepper back, throwing, touchdown. Touchdown to Maxwell. Marcus Maxwell hauls it in, and what a great drive by Dante Culpepper. A drive that started at their own three. He hit a big third down completion to Rod Windsor, and they march it 97 yards, capped off by the TD pass to Maxwell.
And you look at Dante Culpepper, that's a perfect pass to the outside. The defensive back didn't have a chance. Castile didn't have a chance to play on the ball. The one thing about Dante Culpepper in this entire drive, he didn't throw a ball over 13 yards.
And Scotia comes on to tack on the point after. Dante Culpepper, his 7th touchdown pass of the season. Marcus Maxwell, his first TD catch. And Sacramento's on the board.
You better run to Men's Warehouse. Suits are on sale, including designer brands and big and tall. Buy one and get a second suit for just $100. You're gonna like the way you look, I guarantee it.
On an all-new episode of Drinking Made Easy, Zane and the boys make drinking easy in Dallas. First, Zane gets the wrong end of a buffalo.
You think this guy was grazing out in a field and said, hey, I'd love it if my ass was displayed in a bar?
Then kicks it like a cowboy. And Steve feels the wrath of 15 pounds of meat and potatoes.
How, my friends? Puking made easy.
Drinking Made Easy in Dallas. All new episode Wednesday at 8:30 Eastern on HDNet.
How are you?
Guys Night In is taking Thursdays off.
For once, we're gonna do something wholesome.
Sounds like it sucks.
This is messed up, okay?
Here's the problem. You don't have our friends nudity and our friend alcohol.
But don't stress. You can still watch us on Saturday nights.
It's heaven. My heart's going right now thinking about it.
Catch fresh new episodes November 4th.
See? See how it works? It's nice.
Guys Night In returns Thursday, November 4th.
The only thing weird in my mind is that date.
Only on HDNet.
You better run to Men's Warehouse. Suits are on sale, including designer brands and big and tall. Buy one and get a second suit for just $100. You're gonna like the way you look, I guarantee it.
Sacramento is on the board. Dante Culpepper, I heard you say to your offense before that last drive, this is the series we get a touchdown. How'd you know?
Well, just sheer determination. You know, we just had to make our mind up. We had to make our mind up. When we afforded the opportunity to make a play, we got to make our plays.
What was the difference on that drive? You've been struggling, and then suddenly you go 97 yards for a score.
We got into our rhythm, and when we afforded to make a play, we made it. That's simple as that.
Thanks, Dante. Kenny, Paul, back upstairs.
Thanks, Rod, and you can see the rhythm on that last drive, 7-9, 77 of his 101 yards for Culpepper on that drive. It was 14 plays, 97 yards. And capped off with the touchdown pass to Maxwell. Dominic Rhodes will return the kickoff.
Why shouldn't he? He does everything else.
I was going to say, he's also selling popcorn at halftime.
Oh, man.
As Fabricio Scaccia, one of the big legs in this league. He has kicked a 54-yard field goal this season, which tied the record that Nick Novak set the week before. He did it against Florida earlier this year. Booms this one. Rhodes moves up, takes it at the one. Rhodes looked for that opening. It never came as he hit and goes down. And that was Ronnie Palmer, the backup linebacker, making the tackle after a 15-yard return as we have now come up to the 2-minute warning. We'll be back. The Tuskers have the ball.
Pisses you off.
The hardest words are fighting words.
When I don't get my workout in, that pisses me off.
What prepared you for this kind of combat sport?
The way I grew up, being picked on a lot when I was younger.
Can you go into a fight and not hate your opponent?
I know I gotta do what I have to do. He's gonna try to hurt me.
You still are doing those spinning back kicks. How the hell do you do that?
Fighting Words with Mike Straka, tomorrow at 8:30 on HDNet.
you live and learn. You kick and you punch, you feel the pain.
Hi, I'm Kenny Rice.
And I'm Boss Root.
Be sure to join us each week for Inside MMA, bringing you a knockout panel of all-star fighters.
And as always, we take you places where only our cameras can go, and we give you news and highlights you won't find anywhere else.
Nowhere else. Inside MMA, tomorrow night at 9 Eastern, only on HDNet, your
home for MMA.
A tournament with a generation of tradition is adding a new chapter and continues the journey for a new champion. K1 World Max 70 kilograms Final 16. One will stand alone.
The time for Tolkien's Ivan.
On the channel with more MMA events than any other network. Don't miss a minute of action. HDNet Fights. K1 World Max 70 kilograms Final 16. Tomorrow at 10 Eastern on HDNet. Your home for MMA.
Dante Cooper, quarterback of the Sacramento Mountain Lions, and you're watching UFL on HDNet.
At the two-minute warning, Florida leading 10-7, Sacramento a lot of momentum now after that 97-yard drive. Dennis Green was talking to us yesterday. He said among many things that he was upset with in that loss and all those turnovers was the fact that his team lost before the home crowd of 19,000, as it turned out last week in Sacramento. He said, I hate to disappoint them, and we've got two more home games. And that's what he was thinking about, Paul, you know, getting those, if we can get back and pull an upset on the road, get home for two big games.
Well, you know, these two teams are really in desperate straits. First of all, we know that Sacramento, they have to win. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. They have to win in order to, you know, get in the championship game. Florida, they just really can't afford to lose this ball game.
This is the start of three home games for them. Dominic Rhodes goes out. His chin scraped up a little bit on that carry. So for the first time tonight, there's somebody new in the backfield. And there's a flag to start this play.
Penalty. Still first down.
Now both teams still have three timeouts with 1:56 to go here in the first half.
How do you not know the snap count when you just had a two-minute warning? You're on the sidelines for over a minute.
Maurice Hicks is in the backfield for the first time. Bollinger stepping back, he's throwing, and he gets a completion to Poziak, the tight end. And picks up a short gain there before Malvo makes a hit and brings him down.
And we have a timeout on the field.
Now these timeouts will start melting away, I have a feeling, don't you, in this final 1:44?
Well, you know, Denny Green and his team, they figure they can hold this team now. They already proved that they can hold Florida. I mean, they've got 10 points on the board, but this is almost the end of the first half, and that's all they have. The Tuskers, we thought, had a more explosive offense, but apparently Sacramento has found the key to stopping this team.
Trying to rally that defense there. You see Ta'ili'ili, who has played so well. Crum has really been good this year. Maurice Crum in backup situations. His dad, a former star at the University of Miami, Florida. A lot of Florida connections on both sides tonight. Brooks Bollinger, his team has the second best offense in the league coming in here, and tops in passing. They pick up five on that last one. That brings up a second and 10, ball at the 19 of Florida. Bollinger under pressure, throwing it, short completion, now taking off and picking some positive yards out of the situation with Maurice Hicks. They gave it to Maurice Hicks. He's going, I don't know if I wanted this. I got to get out of here.
Well, Maurice Crum, number 55, has got him right there. Look at this. And he lets him go, and he pushes him away. Crum didn't know he had the ball. Look at this. Maurice Crum has got him right here.
He's got him. And
then pushes him away.
Falatoise was putting the pressure on him. John Falatoise, who's filling in along with Schaible for that injury to Holmes on the right inside, putting the pressure on. And nice little scamper there by Maurice Hicks. Picks up six, makes it third and four, ball out to the 25-yard line, 1:32 on the clock. And the timeout was taken by Sacramento. They have one remaining.
thing about it is now Florida gets, you know, picks up 10 or 15 yards. Then they start working on their timeouts because they'll have three.
Big play. Bollinger floating it down the sideline. It has a completion and a first down. And it's Maurice Hicks out of the backfield making the catch.
You know, it's just one of those deals that, you know, sometimes it jumps up and bites you because Sacramento thought, well, we're stopping these guys. And then you've taken two timeouts. Florida still has all three of theirs, and they get out of bounds. And then Maurice Hicks comes out and makes a play. I mean, this ball is now almost, it's at the 48-yard line. They're coming out. They've got all the time in the world now to put at least another three on the board.
A huge play, 23 yards the pick up there. Moves it out near midfield. It's at the 47. And Jay Gruden's team they have all of their timeouts remaining. Bollinger back again. Pressure again, throws over the middle and has the completion. And Malvo coming up to make the hit. And it's Maurice Hicks, who's becoming a dangerous receiver out of the backfield. He's caught three straight in this drive.
Well, you know, they're watching for Dominic Rhodes. He's not in the ballgame, and they've got the receiver that they really like. We talked to Coach Gruden yesterday, and he said, you're going to see an awful lot of Hicks being in that backfield.
Hicks, who spent part of six seasons with the 49ers and the Vikings.
All right, here he is coming out of the backfield, and look at this. Bollinger's looking downfield. He doesn't want to throw the ball to Hicks, but it's an outlet pass. But when he does, number 43, Maurice Hicks, picks up good yardage. He picks up 6 yards on the play. You know what, you still have two timeouts left, and it's a minute 18 in the game. The middle of the field is still your friend. The only problem is when you throw it in the middle of the field, you got Sendejo back there to the 34th. They're going to nail you.
He's already had an interception at the goal line tonight. Andrew Sendejo, the rookie out of Rice University. Ball in the Mountain Lions territory down to the 46 on second and four, 1:18 to go. Gessner goes in motion, top of the screen. Bollinger back. Sets, gunning deep down the sideline for his man. Incomplete. Unloading it for the speedy Calvin Russell. Mays was right with him, and he couldn't bring it in.
Boy, I tell you, this is the first time that Bollinger's actually put it on the target. Now, there, look at Mays, number 25. I mean, this is outstanding coverage. This ball, he didn't have his right arm. He should have caught this football. That ball was put where you should have been able to catch it.
There's Russell. You know his story, perhaps. The guy who made the team through a tryout. Terrell Mays filling in for the injured Robert Bourne. Broke his leg last week, out for the season. Mays doing a great job tonight. Third and four at the 46. Bollinger moves back, steps up, throws across the middle. Incomplete. A little behind the intended receiver, Maurice Price. And it was Sendejo, who is turning in a great game right there with him.
A lot behind him. This ball was not on target. It was way behind. There's no way that Breeze Price could make the catch on this thing.
You got a good look at Andrew Sendejo there as Wood steps back. And it's Ken Parrish ready to kick it away. 1:06 to go here in the first half. Sacramento has one timeout remaining. Woods letting this one roll, and it's going to roll Florida's way, and they will put that down right about the 2-yard line. And that will probably change a lot of the strategy now with only 55 seconds to go. Andrew Sendejo, rookie out of Rice University, who was in the Tampa Bay Bucks minicamp before coming to Sacramento.
Well, I tell you, he just fills it, and he breaks up a pass. He also had an interception. Here comes the interception. I mean, this young man, talk about awareness on the field. He's young. He's got great instincts.
And a big night for Sendejo. Mays has played well also in the secondary. That 44-yard punt by Parrish puts him down to the 2-yard line. Ross is back in and will get the carry and trying to make sure they can hold on to the ball and get this clock down and go to the locker room trailing by only three.
Well, they took their second time out, Florida Tuskers. So they can't, they can only stop the clock one more time. And I just don't think that Dante Culpepper in Sacramento, they're going to take a chance and throw the ball down the field. They'll make him use their last time out. And then Gruden would say, hey, you let 5 seconds too much go off the clock. Really? No, we didn't. Yes, you did.
Yeah, this is home. We're supposed to, home, the home clock always supposed to be in favor.
That's right. Just remember now that, that thing on the scoreboard is not the official time. The official time is kept on the field.
What a great drive for Culpepper, 97 yards, the longest of the season. Capped off by that touchdown pass to Maxwell, the last drive for Sacramento. Converted that big third down from their own three and thrown out of his end zone over the middle to Corey Ross. His Culpepper gets about 7 yards on that. Thurman brings him down at the 10. That clock runs down. Florida will stop it one more time.
And all Sacramento has to do now is just take a knee. And the half's over.
Dante Culpepper, much made, as you might expect, about his return to this Central Florida area. Grew up in Ocala, was a guy that came to Central Florida, which was a mid-sized program trying to get some attention. They start playing Southeastern Conference schools and playing them tough, the likes of South Carolina. They go to Nebraska, led Nebraska at halftime, and the world started finding out about this kid, Dante Culpepper. And Central Florida University, the Golden Knights, now with their own stadium, not too far from here, but this used to be home field for them at the Citrus Bowl. And Culpepper was the fourth overall quarterback taken, the first in history to go in the first round out of Central Florida.
13-1 record here for him.
He loved it here. He certainly looked that way on his last drive. We expect this will be the last play of this half on 3rd and 2. Swings it out to Ross. Ross picks up the first down and then some.
Look at Culpepper. He wants him at the line of scrimmage. There's 24 seconds, but he still has a timeout. I just thought they'd take a knee. But he threw the ball out there to Ross. He said, come on, let's go. We can still, you know, we can still score something.
Well, with 10 seconds to go, at least they appear to be having fun. This is like the old days of drawing it up in the sandlot, isn't it?
That's right, it is.
The two sticks go out, and then the rock moves over here. Culpepper swings it, incomplete for Baylark. And that brings it to half, and I got to believe somewhere over on that Sacramento sideline, they're saying, you know, if it were tipped, if, what could have happened there? Anyway, they got to be thankful that they've had that one great drive, and they're very much in this game at intermission.
Well, they had the hot hand. So he said, hey, if you still have the hot hand, just go with it. Go with your gut. And they did.
Start of three straight at home for Jay Gruden and the Tuskers. They know how big this is for them, and it certainly is a must situation for Dennis Green, and he's standing by now with Ron.
Okay, thanks, Kenny. Coach Green, your offense was stuck in neutral, shut out, and then suddenly you go on your longest drive of the season, 97 yards. What was the difference?
I think the no huddle. I mean, I think we just went to no huddle. I think that's probably more our style. I think we're probably being a little bit too conservative, trying too many runs when we weren't right there and anything. So I just think we loosened up a lot better, went no huddle, and we played more of our style of football.
It seemed the offense got in sync. Your defense once again is playing well. What adjustments do you make at halftime? Will we see more no huddle?
I think we'll do a little bit of everything, I think, to try to make sure that we can get on the field and stay on the field. The key for us now is our kickoff coverage team and then our defense. Our defense is making a lot of good plays. I think we've settled into it. We haven't given up any big plays, knock on wood, so we're looking forward to a much better second half.
You must feel comfortable down at your 2-yard line and you're still throwing.
Well, we just want to make sure that we know that we can throw the ball. I think we acted in the first quarter like maybe we can't throw the ball. We ought to be the best passing team in the league, so we got to come out throwing.
Very good. Thanks, Coach.
You bet.
Okay, Kenny and Paul, back upstairs.
All right, thanks, Ron. There's Jay's brother, John Gruden, is here tonight. The Grudens are legends here in Florida, aren't they? The coaching family. Oh. First time he's seen brother Jay as a head coach.
And here, when you get into the fourth quarter, considering the lead you let get away in Sacramento earlier this year.
Oh, he's got to finish, man. That's our
focus all week is focus and finish, and hopefully we'll get that done.
Good luck. Thank you, Coach. Kenny, one update on Brooks Bollinger. He had a heating pad on his neck in the locker room at halftime from that hit that sent him out for one play. Other than that, he is all right, good to go.
All right. Thank you, Paul. Maybe he got a little hot in the, under the collar as well with some of those passes that were going short.
And how many shots he's taken.
Yeah, Fabrizio Scaccia will kick it off for the Mountain Lions. Standing back is Dominic Rhodes. Kick on the bounce. Rhodes takes it on the hop at the 4. The 15, and he is going down right about there. And that is fellow kickoff returner Aaron Woods, number 83, in there to make the hit.
Here's a good part about the fact that Florida gets the ball in the second half. First of all, Dante Culpepper had to go to the locker room. That's 12 to 15 minutes are in there. And to keep the ball away from him, he really had Dante had the upper hand in that second quarter. And he is hot. He just can't wait to get in. Cool him down. Just keep the ball for a while.
Rhodes 13 carries, 60 yards tonight. And a touchdown. Culpepper 14 for 23, 114 yards and a touchdown. And there is Rhodes after a little bit of a break near the end of the first half and halftime, like Paul said. Dominic picks it right back up. His 14th carry of the game. He gets about a yard or so on that. Parker moves in to make the tackle, Jason Parker.
I remember all the years that Dominic Rhodes played in the NFL for Indianapolis. The one thing about that guy, this guy, Dominic Rhodes, is the longer the game goes on, the better he gets. And he really starts to unload.
Second and 9 at the 19. Bollinger back, flips the screen, and it is dropped. Incomplete. He was going for J.D. Runnels, the fullback.
Yeah, well, there's a fake here to Dominic Rhodes, and he gets a piece of the defensive tackle. That's a nice block by Rhodes. Pull the ball out to the fullback, and that'll be the last time they throw the ball to you, Runnels, this game. But he doesn't touch the ball on a run. Most of the fullbacks in this league do not.
No, there is no rule saying that they can't catch a pass.
You're allowed.
We've actually seen Rome catch one for a touchdown this year.
You're allowed to catch him.
Here it is, 3rd and 9. Opening series, second half for Florida. Bollinger steps back, throws, and it's knocked down. Malvo gets a hand on it. Kelly Malvo and Terrell Mays, they're filling in for the injured Robert Bourne, alternating at that corner, and both have played well tonight.
Is it me or they that not the quarterbacks not throwing the ball? Look at this ball float. This ball gives the defense to get back against the pass, and Malvo was there. That ball just hung in the air again.
Once again, Calvin Russell standing there and the ball not getting to him. Wood stands back and Ken Parrish will kick it away. Aaron Woods is going to let this short one just bounce and roll, and good field position for the Mountain Lions as it rolls down to about the 42-yard line. Culpepper and company getting ready to go.
Greetings, America. If you wear UFL gear, you'll never look this good. Most of us will never look this good. But if you wear UFL gear, you're gonna look good.
UFL jerseys, caps, tees, and more are available now. Go to buyufl.com. The United Football League. If you like great football, you'll love the UFL.
HDNet Halloween. Race Hell. With the premiere of
Avenged Sevenfold. You can't catch my drift, can't catch my wave.
They gon' try to intrude, watching the multitude. They be quick to accuse, when you got different views. Just know you gon' pay the price, but suck the item you choose. Advertising the culture, hit you with them cap ultra. I knew you was a vulture, holy ghost get the ushers. No, I can't trust you, shock you, then now you flustered. Crashing down, I was cluttered, doing sort of. Falling up through the rubble, remember this a jungle. The top, I was gonna get something, the middle, gotta stay hunting. Why don't rush up for nothing, why don't rush up for nothing. Why don't rush up for nothing, why don't rush up for nothing. Agitated illusion, only bitch from confusion. Rulers an institution, modern day execution. Think I got the solution, maybe. That's what I do. Just put it in the music. Just put it in the music.
Someone put me out. Falcons, he knows he's got things to
perform. Everything is in his
court. I can't even keep all what they say. They've been searching for that thing to get to my eye. Who can catch my juke, can't catch my way.
That is a league record. He had three touchdowns. That was then. Here's what he's already done.
That's what paying my dues. They won't try to intrude. Cause you the multitude. They be quick to accuse. When you got different views, just know you gon' pay the price. But it's not the item you choose.
Ties in the culture. Hit you with the capocha. I knew you was a vulture.
Including J.R. Reed, who's out for the season. Fakir Brown, who's out again tonight. First and 10 at the 43. Good field position for the Mountain Lions. And Windsor is back in, starting here in the second half. Rod Windsor. Culpepper throws it, dropped by the usually sure-handed Yaley, Nate Lowry.
Well, you know, this, I like this pattern because it, what it really does, it frees up the biggest man that you have out in the pattern. It's a three-man pattern to the left of Culpepper. And watch this, Lowry, I mean, that ball hits him in the hands. You got to catch it. And when you don't, you know, it draws the crowd anyway, even if you drop it.
Windsor, wide left, he's at the bottom of your screen. Ross on the ground at the 50. First down, Ross, down to around the 41-yard line. That's the big run they've been waiting for on the night from Corey Ross.
Oh, Corey Ross. I mean, this thing was set up by the last play. Watch Corey Ross on this play and the blocking by the offensive line. And the guards get out front. That's Bibla, number 66, who had pulled and got into the play. Just a nice play by the offensive line.
Biggest run tonight for Ross. He picks up 15, first and 10, down to the 42 of Florida. They'll stay on the ground with Ross. Not that time. Flag comes in. Ross was met and brought down almost right on the spot. Boykin is there. That's McKinley Boykin out of the University of Mississippi, one of the protected players they certainly wanted to keep on this team.
That's either, I mean, that's... Is it holding by the offensive line again?
During the play, holding by the offense, number 66. That's a 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Replay first down.
He's the guy that just made the great play on the block, and then Bibla, number 66. You saw him, he got out in front of Corey Ross on the play before. Now here's Bibla, number 66, and he is definitely holding right there, right at the point of attack, and you're out in the middle. You know, this is, again, the thing that drives Denny Green and all coaches absolutely crazy. You're in a super drive. You're moving the ball. You've been moving it since the second quarter. And then you come up with a holding penalty to put you back 10.
Culpepper started the game 5 for 12. Since then, he's been hot 9 for 12 and 77 yards. First and 20, back in the 48 in their own territory. Swings this out to Corey Ross back across midfield. He gets close to the 40 before going out of bounds. Ross, the lead receiver in the league, coming in tonight with 27 catches, hauls this one in.
It's another screen. This is about the fifth or sixth screen that we've seen from Sacramento. And what better to get the ball in the hands of Corey Ross? They want to get them. They hand it to him when he runs the ball, and then they kind of just drop it off to him. This is a designed screen pass. And there's old Bibla, number 66, out in front again.
He picks up 12 on that, his fifth catch of the night. He has 32 on the season, adding to that on the quick slant, incomplete, going for Joe West. Couldn't quite hook up there, and that's Tribble, DeJuan Tribble on the coverage.
I don't think old Joe West saw this ball. I mean, watch him fire this. Dante Culpepper, bam! And that thing, you know, Joe West put a hand up. You're looking at him like, and you expected me to catch that? I don't think so.
Now it's third and 8 at the 40. Culpepper saying something to Ross. Sacramento 4 out of 9 on third downs. And they've been on a roll on these third downs. Culpepper steps up, throwing this time complete to West. West taking it in, but he stepped out of bounds at around the 15. Culpepper that time found his man and picks up a key first down.
Oh, man, I'll tell you what. This is just a nice play. Just take a look at this play on the outside. Joe West makes the play. He does step out of bounds. The official was there. But, I mean, the perfect throw, that's Tribble that misses the play. But, you know, that ball was purposely thrown short so that West could come back to get it.
22 yards on that play, first and 10, down to the 18. And we got a challenge flag thrown from the Tusker sideline.
Well, what?
Or no, rather from the Sacramento sideline, I think, because that's where it's coming from. Denny Green questioned if you went out. No, it's Gruden.
It's Gruden.
Although we will point out, we've seen the dueling challenges earlier this year.
Challenging the ruling on the field of a completed catch.
What they're contesting is when the ball was thrown, did he have control of it when he stepped out of bounds? That's what they're challenging. It is the fact that he caught it. He did it. But did he have the control? And we don't see it from their cadet side. But, man, yeah, he does. Yeah, he does. That ball is in. It's tucked in. Take a look at it from here. Take a look at his right arm. He's got the ball. The ball, now he moves it to his left. He's in control when he steps out because he steps out there. And he had already changed the ball from hand to hand.
Yeah, I think the better argument could have been if Green thought he hadn't stepped out of bounds, which obviously he did as well.
Yeah, he did. He did step out of bounds. But look, he has control. When that right foot comes underneath and goes out of bounds, that ball is already tucked away in his left hand. Good call. This is a good catch.
22 yards as it stands now. It's under review. Remember, Chris Snead, the referee, and the officials are seeing what you see. They're looking at the HD net shots. And that's what's under that hood.
Well, you know, the reason, one of the coaches from upstairs, what he probably saw was him switching hands. When he switched hands, he was still in bounds. That's what he was looking at. If he's getting the word from upstairs to challenge it, obviously they didn't see him tuck the ball away. He had the ball tucked. There was just no question about it. Take a look. You watch him here. He catches the ball in his left hand, okay, now, or his right hand. Now he switched it to his left. Steps out of bounds after he has control of the football. Boom, the ball's there in his right. Watch him switch it to his left. It's under control. Now he steps out of bounds there. There's no question about this being a catch. I should have been an official. Should have been something.
You could have been a contender. You could have been an official. But would you have been as good as Larry Upson?
No, no.
Who oversees it all. Glad to have you up in the booth again, Larry. Thanks for coming by.
And he comes by all the time when they make a great call.
He does, and that was a great call.
No, he's here when there were bad calls too, pal. I can tell you that.
After reviewing the play is confirmed. The ball we put at the 17.5 yard line. Please reset game clock to 12:37. Florida is charged with a timeout.
So it stands as we expected. Joe West making the big catch. Last year when it was the old California Redwoods, he was the second leading receiver on the team, former star at Texas El Paso. At the end of the first quarter, Sacramento had 23 total yards. Since then, they've had 146 yards. That's the roll that they're on, and Culpepper now 148 of those yards passing tonight.
Culpepper, they unleashed the lion.
They've turned him loose. He's feeling like it's old times. He's probably saying golden nights go. He's back at Central Florida. First time he's played on this field in a dozen years. He'll go to the ground with Corey Ross. Not much going on that one. Harrison leading the way to make that first hit.
You know, when they didn't have Windsor in the game, I thought that Florida played is a very good man. The winds are still on the sidelines. They're going to spot play him.
Second and 10 at the 18. Culpepper back. Rolling left, looking, tucks it in, and will step out, loses a couple. And Chukwuera was giving chase. Patrick Chukwuera, who is second in the league right now in sacks, at one time was the sack leader. He has 2.5 sacks on the season. He has been injured, came back into action, was injured again, and they were thrilled with his performance 2 weeks ago against Hartford when he had a couple of sacks and recovered a fumble.
Oh, that's a loss on a play. Isn't that a sack? I mean, he ran him out of bounds before he got the line of scrimmage. That's a sack.
Lost five, so that would move him into the tie now with teammate Claremont for 3.5 sacks on the season. He's picked up 3 in his last 2 games on 1st and 15 at the 23. Culpepper, and the pressure was on, and that was Chukwuera in there again among others, and he throws that right at the feet of Corey Ross, and it brings up 4th down.
One of the things that Dante Culpepper will say to his offensive line, hey, let me explain something to you guys. I know it's a screen, but you got to hold him up just a moment. You know, you got to make like a 1-2 count, and then let go and get back out in the blocking situation. Don't let them all come at me at once.
Fabricio Scaccia now trying a 41-yard field goal. He's 4 of 6 on the season. Along the 54. Good snap and a knuckleball that comes up way short. It was deflected. Castilla got a piece of it. And that is still 10-7.
On an all-new episode of Drinking Made Easy, Zane and the boys make drinking easy in Dallas. First, Zane gets the wrong end of a buffalo.
You think this guy was grazing out in a field and said, hey, I'd love it if my ass was displayed in a bar.
Then kicks it like a cowboy. And Steve feels the wrath of 15 pounds of meat and potatoes.
How, my friends? Puking made easy.
Drinking Made Easy in Dallas. All new episode Wednesday at 8:30 Eastern on HDNet.
Hi, I'm Alex Gibney, and I'd like to invite you to an exclusive sneak preview of my movie, Client 9, The Rise and Fall of Elliot Spitzer. It premieres in theaters on Friday, November 5th, or you can watch it at home right now before anyone else gets to see it. Here's how.
Here's your chance to watch an exclusive advanced screening of a full-length feature film before it hits theaters. Client 9, The Rise and Fall of Elliot Spitzer is available now on demand.
These are the guys that got us to the brink of disaster. And Elliot Spitzer was after them years before the collapse occurred.
What I was intrigued by, the number of people that were terrified by him.
He was going to be our first Jewish president.
I will never forget that moment.
I was dumbfounded.
I have acted in a way that violates my obligations to my family, and that violates my or any sense of right and wrong.
Magnolia Pictures presents Client 9, The Rise and Fall of Elliot Spitzer. Watch it now before it's in theaters.
10-7, Florida leads Sacramento. And what a play by Simeon Castile, who made a great play to block that punt. A kick, rather.
Well, I'm going to tell you something, Kenny. Look at the extension. He's going to come off the right-hand side, far right. Now watch. Right now, stop. Look at the extension, this guy. Look where he is and look where the ball is. And he does it right in front of the kicker where he's going to be able to block the ball. Bang! Is that beautiful or what?
Castile stretching all 6 feet of him out. And the former Alabama star making a big defensive play, as did Patrick Chukwuerah, who required it another sack. He has 3.5 now on the season to move it into a tie for the league lead. So, Paul, you wonder, as you were discussing during the commercial there, how will this help turn things around now, perhaps for Florida after that big defensive stand?
Well, we knew that when Windsor came in, he made a big change in Sacramento's team. And then now we're going to find out if it does a thing for this offense of Florida, because they have been stinking up the place for a long time. That is another pass play by Bollinger that's thrown way behind the receiver.
He and Calvin Russell, they're like watching a different movie tonight.
The thing about it is that, you know, we saw last week Dante Culpepper and a couple times in this game try to guide the ball, and it just looks like that's what Bollinger's doing.
Five incomplete passes in a row for Bollinger. That is so rare. I don't think it ever happened last year. Throws it over the middle. This is a short game complete to Maurice Hicks coming out of the backfield. And Zig Marino, we've seen him limp to the sideline, favoring his ankle a couple of times, but he's back in there starting at middle linebacker here in the second half and makes the tackle.
How tough is this guy? I mean, they know how important this guy is to them. He is their middle linebacker. He is their play caller. And when you see a guy that hurts his ankle, and he did turn it and get back in the game, he left twice in this ball game.
Pick up a 7, 3rd and 3 out to the 37. Bollinger deep drop, firing it deep down the sideline, and it's knocked away.
Good play.
Great play made by Marcus McCauley.
You know, I'm telling you, this ball is just hanging in the air. Look at Marcus McCauley. Look at how far he has to come to make the play. I mean, it's unbelievable. You see Dennis Keys, number 22, comes from the middle of the field. McCauley is the guy. I mean, that ball should have been caught, should have been deep enough, and let the receivers run under it.
McCauley making a huge play, former star at Fresno State. He was going for the tight end, Galen Stone, on that. As standing back now and waiting for the punt and taking it is Aaron Woods. So, Florida, they stall. Sacramento gets their turn.
I'm Andre Dixon, running back from the Hartford Colonials.
What a hit. He dives in for the score.
I go to UFL-football.com for team news, player profiles, apparel, stats, and anything else UFL related.
Visit UFL-football.com for the latest information on your favorite UFL players. The United Football League. If you like great football, you'll love the UFL.
This November, HDNet Fights is the place to be for MMA's biggest events. First, the World's Elite takes center stage, and only one will stand victorious. Sengoku Raiden Championship 15. Plus, MMA vets and Los Angeles superstars look to leave their mark. Maximum Fighting Championship, Breaking Point. Then, the world's most feared strikers prepare for battle. K1 World Max 2010. Every Friday in November on HDNet, your home for MMA.
What pisses you off?
The hardest words are fighting words.
When I don't get my workout in, that pisses me off.
What prepared you for this kind of combat sport?
The way I grew up, being picked on a lot when I was younger.
Can you go into a fight and not hate your opponent?
I know I gotta do what I have to do. He's gonna try to hurt me.
You still are doing those spinning back kicks. How the hell do you do that?
Fighting Words with Mike Straka. Tomorrow at 8:30 on HDNet.
You live and learn. You kick and you punch, you feel the pain.
Dante Culpepper on that play that Chuck Wehrer ran him out of bounds for the sack. Watch him pull up short as he gets out of bounds. And they were working on his right hamstring. Look at this. I mean, he did slow down, and now he tweaked it a little bit. Question is now, Dennis Green told us that in the second half, they went to the hurry-up offense. Now, you know, you, obviously coming out of a timeout, you don't go to what. It'll be interesting to see if they do that. And look at he, that thing is hurting him, man. And he really depends on his legs.
And Culpepper, we saw not the vintage that was such greatness when he played at Central Florida in his early days for the Vikings, but he can still move pretty well. Ross in the backfield gets the handoff straight up the middle. Nice first down run for Corey Ross, who is finding his rhythm as well here as this game continues along.
And again, you know, that number, now it's second down and four. When you pick up five and six yards on first down, it really does. It opens your whole playbook up.
Again, Ross. Not a lot of room there. Carlton Powell makes the tackle. He's one of the guys that's been coming in and out of the lineup because of some of the injuries, trying to plug some of the holes. So much so that Jake Gruden said he gets confused sometimes who some of his players are. He's calling out that number because he's had to make about a half a dozen changes on his offensive line and his secondary since week one.
And I'll tell you, it drives the coaches nuts because, you know, first thing you got to teach the guy your system. You got to teach him, you know, the guys next to him aren't sure of what you do.
Big third down, they're 5 of 11. Culpepper, third and four. Steps back, fires it over the middle. Well, incomplete. And that was intended for Otis Amy, and nowhere near it.
Otis Amy, and Culpepper had time to throw this ball. Otis Amy, just take a look at where the ball's thrown. It's thrown behind him. Now, I know he wanted to throw that thing a little bit short so Otis Amy could come back to it, but the problem is the ball wasn't far enough.
So Tom Malone, he thought he was probably going to kick more than any punter in the history of the game in those opening five drives when he kept coming on. Now steps in and boots it away. Avian Kaysen standing back takes it. Staggers up to about the 34 before he goes down. 9-yard return before Aaron King brings it down. Inside the 10, the 5, touchdown!
The first meeting was all Vegas.
There's nothing better than winning. Nothing better.
Omaha's dream season far from over.
We want to be that last team standing.
The push for postseason is on. Every game matters.
We're a physical team, and we're in good shape.
Every team is capable. Every single week is critical.
The UFL on HDNet, Las Vegas and Omaha. Coverage begins live next Thursday night, 7:30 Eastern, only on HDNet.
And this event is crazy, huh?
It's the best time ever.
I recommend this party.
Why not, baby? Let's start dancing.
It felt so nice. I loved it.
And you know, ease up in there.
Anything for a customer, huh?
How does it feel?
It feels a little awkward.
Officially the hottest girl in America. Thank you, HDNet.
I like to get drunk.
Goodbye.
You gotta get it.
There will be there will be drunk people everywhere.
Cheers to the red, white, and blue.
I haven't had my legs this far open since college. Come on, come on.
I was just having fun with friends.
I want to see myself on HDNet.
She's just six.
That was fantastic.
To go in the third quarter, 10-7. Florida is leading Sacramento. Important game for Florida, the start of three straight at home. They're only a game back of first place in the UFL and a must game for the 1-3 Mountain Lions. And here comes Brooks Bollinger. 12 of 23, 102 yards on the night, been intercepted once. He has Maurice Hicks as the setback. Bollinger stops, pops, now fires it down low, and it's incomplete. Once again, the flag comes flying. He was going for Maurice Price. Malvo was with him, and this is going to be a nice gain on the penalty.
You have to turn, Kenny, as you know, and back and look at the ball. At least make an attempt on the ball. Malvo did not do this. He just looked at the receiver and then put his hand up in his face.
Pass interference by the defense, number 24. Ball be placed at the spot of the foul. Automatic first down.
And this ball, you know, this look at it, a little fake, a little pump action. He looks to his right, and then Bollinger comes back. Now watch Malvo, 24. He just puts his hands up in the face of the receiver, and the receiver really doesn't have a chance to catch the ball. That's Maurice Price, number 17. No attempt to knock the ball down, but to knock the receiver down.
That moves it all the way down to the 31. A big break perhaps for Florida here on this drive. Bollinger will keep it on the ground, and Hicks will pick up a first down inside the 20, and then some. He keeps going. Keys among those trying to bring him down. So that 35-yard penalty for pass interference, and now that's followed up by this nice run of 16 by Hicks.
Hicks is there, but the middle linebacker, Zeke Marino, I mean, he just watched him. He runs right by him. He doesn't even see the ball. Watch it. Look at 57. He's now in the backfield. He went, whoops. I had a shot, but I didn't miss. I missed him.
For Hicks, biggest run so far this season, 16 yards. It's first and 10 at the 16. Florida, the best team in the league in the red zone. Only once they haven't been able to put it in this year. They'll stay on the ground, and the ball is loose. It's fumbled, and it's picked up. Picked up by Sendejo. He's had an interception, and he's recovered a fumble tonight. And a huge break for Sacramento.
I said about Sendejo that here's a guy who's really aware of everywhere he is on the field. Now, that's Hicks. Now watch this. His ball is in his right hand. It looks like it has it tucked away. But then the hit is done by number 22, Keys. And then Sendejo, I mean, you would think the guy would fall on the ball, but he's got such good hands. Here comes Hicks, helmet on the ball, the ball's out, and look who's there. Number 34, Sendejo. Boy, if he makes this thing clear, he may have had a shot to the end zone.
Sendejo picks it up. Keys causes the interception. Number 22 caused it. Number 34 picked it up. And a big fumble there by Maurice Hicks, who just come off the best run he's had all season. Now it's Sacramento's turn, and Corey Ross goes to work right up the middle. Sendejo now puts his name in the running for Defensive Player of the Week with the performance he's had tonight.
I mean, you look at the guys like that. This guy is so aware of where he is on the field, and he's aware of where everything's at. Now, I know that was a running play, and it got back to the outside. But it just shows his awareness as a safety to be up and make the play.
Only the second time this year Florida got in the red zone and could not convert. Play action. Culpepper running, being chased, firing, and on the money he is. He's letting them know. Joe West, in case there's any question, I caught that ball right between the 1 and the 9.
So much for the hamstring of Dante Culpepper. Now, he is limping a little bit back to the huddle, but when he makes this move back to the outside, look at it. Look at the speed. And watch where this ball is on target. West is right there. He knows where he is on the sideline. Make sure he has his feet in bounds, and the ball is thrown perfectly. There's nothing you can do about this throw. Nothing.
A beauty. 14 yards for the first down. Let's check it out with Ron, who's standing by with a defensive star here.
Without a doubt, the defensive star, Andrew Sendejo. Great play there. Picked up the fumble. Goes along with an interception. Describe how that play developed.
Well, really, that wasn't my play. I believe it was the safety that ran downhill, made a great play, got the ball out. I just happened to be there. You know, that's what we expect to do. That's what we practice all the time, flying to the ball, getting turnovers. So, really, I mean, that's nothing special for us. That's what we expect.
After giving up an early touchdown, this defense has really cracked down. What are you guys doing that's really making it difficult for their offense?
We're just sticking to our game plan, really. What we practice all week, we're just trying to execute it at the best that we can. So, that's really all we're doing right now is just executing.
Perfect. Thanks for the time.
Thank you.
Okay, Kenny?
Thanks, Ron. They were working on number 65, the center, Mike Mabry, who was a star at Central Florida after Culpepper played. And he gets a break right now, I believe.
Well, if they take a timeout for him, they have to take him out.
Yeah, Matt Lentz comes in. Matt Lentz now at center on first and 10. Culpepper, see if that hand's still hot, throwing it over the middle, and it is to West once again.
Well, you talk about a guy running free across the middle. Now, West just got underneath the linebackers in front of the safeties, and this, and Culpepper knew where he was going to be. The biggest problem the quarterbacks have had so far this year is that the receiver's not getting where they're supposed to. This time, West did. Look at him. He's in front of the safeties, in front of the linebackers, and he makes the play.
West picks up six, second and four, out to the 35. Ross Delone set back, and he gets the carry on a little bit of a draw, and he's brought down. Chuck Wera makes the tackle.
Now they're working on Mabry on the sidelines. He's on the bench, and they're taping his ankle again.
Now Culpepper, of course, getting all the attention, but this a homecoming as well for Mike Mabry, starting center for this team.
You know, one of the things in football, if the quarterback goes down, there's a timeout, and you know the quarterback's loosened up. If you have a center who's really the key player in your offensive line, he goes down, they got to put a new center in right now, and he hasn't had a chance to make a snap.
That's Matt Lentz, who formerly was with the Tuskers. He's in at center now on third and three from the 36. Dumps it over the middle to Ross. Ross going for the first down, gets to the 45, ball flying out of bounds, but not before Corey Ross is able to pick up the first down, outrunning Anthony Schlegel to the sideline.
Well, Schlegel gets in. Schlegel's leaving now. He's just holding his hand. I don't know whether he hurt that on the play. We have another defensive
that's
man.
Savé,
that's
Savé, it looks like. Is that Brian
that's
Savé,
Savé is down.
98.
And look at Culpepper. He's going to get nailed right here by Savé, who goes down. But he gets the ball off to Corey Ross, who picks up the first down.
They pick up eight. That moves the ball up to the 44. They'll mark it now at the 43. And it'll be first and 10 as they continue to work on Brian Savé.
Kenny, we did the first game of the year with Florida out in Vegas, and we saw a whole bunch of guys going down. And here we go again. There are a lot of people taking a knee in this ball game, getting hurt. And here's Savé, he comes out, and then Corey Ross goes back to the outside. Schlegel is a guy that took over in the middle for McGargle, but the thing about Schlegel is that he had a chance to play a game before this game here.
There goes Savé, played last year in the UFL with the New York Sentinels, out of Colorado State. Carlton Powell will come in to replace him. And Carlton Powell, of course, was brought in. Now Langston Moore, a defensive tackle, is out with a torn bicep. Chris Harrison is out with the knee. He is gone for the season. So with Harrington out for the season and Langton on a week-to-week basis, they brought Powell back in, Carlton Powell. They've had to fill in a lot of places here in these last 3 or 4 weeks because of injuries. First and 10 at the 43 for Culpepper. 175 yards passing tonight for Culpepper. He's really found his rhythm since the second quarter. Deep drop. He's looking. He'll fire it out in the flat and get the first down to Lowry, the tight end. Or it's going to come up short of the first down, rather, but a nice play on first down to get it to Lowry and get him in that workable situation.
Man, has he got the time to throw the ball late. I mean, that time, the defensive tackles tried to cross and put on a stunt for the offensive lineman. They just stayed on their ground. And Culpepper just stood back there. He could have stayed there as long as he wanted to because there was nobody near him.
He picks up five. That makes it second and five. That's what Dennis Green talked about. Let's get in those manageable second and third down situations, something we haven't done that well this year. Maxwell in the slot at the bottom of the screen. Culpepper back, has Lowry open. He's gunning it deep down the sideline. Has his man complete in 80, but he was just out of bounds.
Well,
had a foot right on the line there, looked.
Well, Kenny, he had one foot down, but the other one was way out of bounds. But look at this pass. Look at the protection. Culpepper's got all day to throw the football. Here it comes to Amy. Now watch his feet. Boom, boom. His right foot is in. Now watch the left foot, how far out it is.
Yeah. A couple of times he's gone down the sideline and had a... almost.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, though, he's making these guys really think in that secondary because Culpepper is spreading the ball all over the place.
He's keeping it moving. In motion is Biddle. Third and five at the 48. Culpepper drops it off to the safety valve. Ross is going to come up way short this time. That's Odell Thurman in there to make the play. Melton coming over to help out. The outside linebackers doing their job. So it's fourth and four at the 49.
Boy, they just try to get Ross out of the backfield and sneak him out and a little check off to him. But I'll tell you, we talked earlier about Odell Thurman. I mean, he just played that play perfectly.
Malone kicking to Avion Kaysen. Fair catch, takes it around the eight. It's going to be a long field. Dante Culpepper and company having to kick it away on that possession.
Manhouse.com. Go beyond the scores and stats. Get the story behind the story from an all-star cast of writers who tell it like it is. Your sports live here. So step inside Manhouse.com.
Hey guys, Kara Zavaleta here, your host of HDNet's original series, Get Out, part of HDNet's Guys Night In.
If you want it, come get it. Come get it.
So it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun.
Every Thursday and Saturday night, we offer the craziest and most hilarious programming you will ever see on television.
We love the competition. We love sweat. We love the party.
Everything from gorgeous bathing beauties to some of the most hilarious stories from around the world.
What's wrong? Why are you grabbing your butt?
Mom, if you're watching this, please don't get upset.
Hi, Mom.
And let's not forget, the night ends with unrated programming that is hot, hot, and oh so hot, baby.
There's a double rainbow.
It's beautiful.
It's beautiful. It's a double rainbow.
High five up here.
Yeah, she's a delicious lady.
It's time to do it.
So join me, Kara Zavaleta, every Thursday and Saturday night on HDNet's Guys Night In. Sure to be one hell of a good time.
You better run to Men's Warehouse. Suits are on sale, including designer brands and big and tall. Buy one and get a second suit for just $100. You're gonna like the way you look, I guarantee it.
And welcome back. Probably the most famous dance in all of sports being performed by some of the fans here of the Tuskers in Orlando. Kenny Rice, Paul McGuire. Ron Kruk, Paul Crane on the sideline. Home team Florida's leading at 10-7. They jumped out to a 10-0 lead. A 97-yard drive in the second quarter by Dante Culpepper and crew. Made it 10-7. No scoring here in the third quarter. Here's Brooks Bollinger on the night. 12 for 23, 102 yards. He was intercepted at the goal line.
I'll tell you. Play clock was down to 12 seconds, and as Bollinger came on, they wound it to 25 seconds because all the players were on the field just screaming at him to get on the field.
Rhodes back in. And Rhodes gets the carry, looked like he banged off his own man and came up a little short on that. Marino was in the vicinity, number 57, the middle linebacker. And there's a look at Dominic Rhodes saying, hey, give me some room here, guys.
He banged off his own man because one of the defensive guys threw his own man at him. watch Dominic Rhodes. He's really thinking right about now I want to turn up. But watch this. Bang. Here comes his blockers right back in his face.
That was Ontarius Thomas, the outside linebacker that just pushed him into the, caused that traffic jam there, moving back the offensive line. On second and 11, and he goes down for a safety. Bollinger, Maurice Crum among those leading that charge to get in there. Maurice Crum making a huge defensive play.
If all the ways, I'm going to tell you something right now. He was number 93. He was in there. I mean, I don't know who you really want to give it to. You can give it to probably the entire defense. Wouldn't be so bad. But take a look at right up the middle. Here comes Bollinger. He had no chance whatsoever. And that just, Crum was there.
Falatoese was right there too. 93 Falatoese and 55 Maurice Crum. Co-credit, I think, for that.
I would hope so. And I'm going to tell you, these guys were coming. And you can blitz. Just remember one thing now. You can't cover all three, two guards in the center. So take a look at it. You see the right guard is uncovered. But you can send six people on a pass play. And they did that. And they got to him. Because Marino, number 57, was there, and Crum, the other linebacker, both linebackers were there.
And along with Crum was John Falatoese. You see the 286-pound rookie out of UC Davis. Of course, UC Davis has that Causeway Classic rivalry with Sacramento State, so he's well-known in the area. And Falatoese, who is playing more tonight because, again, Lewis Holmes, the starting defensive right end, is out because of a hamstring injury. And Falatoese playing a big game.
I'm going to tell you, this entire ball game, Sacramento's defense, they've just been handing it to the Florida offense.
Tay Biddle stands back along with Aaron Woods, awaiting Ken Parrish's punt. 10-9, big defensive play again. This is Woods with it at the 40. He's going to get to about the 42. Gessner comes in. Everyone trying to hang on there and bring him down. He gets about 11 on that. Joe Claremont leading the way on that tackle.
There's Dante Culpepper out on the field first, rooting his offense.
So Sacramento starts first and 10 at the 43. They have good field position. And we'll see how that momentum keeps going for them now after the big play, the safety. Corey Ross, the lone setback. Gets the carry. Tries to slip one tackle, but that's about it. Boykin was in there first to get a little hand on him. A big hand, actually.
And there's a flag on a play. I didn't see face mask on this thing now. Boykin got him by the shoulder pads.
Chris Need, the referee.
Foul, personal foul, face mask by the defense, number 68. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. Automatic first down.
Well, Boykin was complaining and pleading his case. All right, he's on the left-hand side. He's going around. There it is.
Yeah.
He grabs him by the face mask. I thought he had him by the back of the jersey. What an outstanding call.
Good call. Big penalty. Moves it down to the 43-yard line. Baylark gets the call. Steve Baylark at the University of Massachusetts. We saw him last week turn in a couple of nice runs. He's averaging right around 7 yards a carry this season.
And Dante Culpepper wants to hurry up offense now. He doesn't want the defense to be able to do any kind of changing. Now there's a timeout.
Baylark picking up a yard. Florida, I believe, taking that timeout is Patrick Chukwuera. You see him, who's already picked up a sack tonight. He has 3.5 on the season. It puts him in a tie for the league lead with his teammate, Joe Claremont. Each team has punted 7 times tonight. The UFL record is 8.
They're both going to break it?
They're both, well, they could. There's a good chance of that with 2:34 to go in the third.
How many is it? We need to find out how many is a total in one game by both teams. Because they may shatter that baby.
They may do it. Dante Culpepper certainly hoping that his is not the next team to punt. Like to keep this thing going after a safety and then getting a shorter field to work with. Chukwuera now going out. Patrick Chukwuera, he has had He's been back and forth all season long. Again, coming off a great game 2 weeks ago and an important road win with Hartford. 100 yards in penalties tonight against Sacramento and 40 against Florida. 2.5 minutes to go here in the third, second and eight.
It's, you know, if you sit here watching this game, it's hard to believe that Florida's winning.
Yeah, it is. It's been a long time since they've had any kind of rhythm going in this game. Jumping out to that 10-0 lead. Here it is, second and eight, the 41. Culpepper drops back, goes over the middle with it. Corey Ross, and Ross trying to make a move, but that's really hard to do when Thurman is in the vicinity.
You know, we talked about him a number of times tonight, but Odell Thurman is just, I mean, you talk about making plays. He's number 52. And watch this, he sees Corey Ross getting the ball. Watch the play he makes. He comes back up right here and makes the tackle. I mean, just outstanding for a linebacker.
Third and six after that short completion. Ball down at the 40.
They're coming.
Sacramento 6-14 on third down. Culpepper steps up, drawing and deflected, goes off the shoulder pads of Tate Biddle, the intended receiver, and incomplete.
I'll tell you, they send them all. Take a look at Culpepper's right-hand side. That's a safety and a corner coming. I don't know if they had too many guys. You can only rush six.
That was close. Well, Tom Malone now will get to set the record with his eighth punt. He's the first to set the UFL record for most punts in a game. Kaysen steps back.
He just set the record for height.
Nice punt. It's not going to be great in terms of distance, but he got it inside the 20.
And he kicked it outside the stadium.
I think he hit a bird overhead. That was really up there. Only 26 yards on it, but he kept it inside the 20 down to the 15. There's the last three of the Tuskers, a safety. The last time out for that, they fumbled it away when they got in the red zone, and Maurice Hicks fumbled when they had the ball inside the 10. And then they punted it away to start everything. And coming out at quarterback now is Chris Bryson. We saw him earlier make the one pass when Bollinger was complaining of a sore neck and went out for only one play back in the first half. Bryson now comes in, taking over at his own 14 on first and 10. Bryson pitched back to Rhodes. Rhodes trying to go back the other way, being chased and brought down by who else? The defensive star tonight, Andrew Zendejo. An interception, a fumble recovery, and he was all over that play.
Bryson was going to try to throw a block, and I thought, man, this is not a great decision. Thank goodness he missed a block. But watch Zendejo, number 34. Now, you watch him on your left of your screen. Look at this guy, and look at the perfect tackle that he makes. That's not a fumble, folks. That ball, he was down.
And A.J. Schabel did a nice job to also help redirect that play from the tackle position. A loss of four, second and 14, back to the 10. Bryson drops back. He's unloading down the sideline. And the only guys in that vicinity there all had white jerseys on.
Well, Cortez Hankton cut the playoff. Now, either a miss. I mean, miscommunication between a quarterback and the wide receiver. Now watch it. Cortez, Hank, watch this. See him pull out on the left-hand side of the screen? Thank goodness he threw the ball. Bryson threw the ball far enough. But watch, here's Hankton. Watch him. He's going to break the route off. He's open. But the reason that the defensive back took off is because he saw the ball being thrown.
Marcus McCauley was the closest there. It's third and 14. Bryson again, setting up, throwing, has his completion out to the 20, and that's as far as it goes. Pick a number, somebody was in on it. Mays was there, Marino was there. And you see shaking up a little bit was Calvin Russell.
Track was never like this.
And this down now to the fourth quarter. Third quarter coming to an end. Florida leading it 10-9. They're getting ready to punt it away, and Sacramento should have good field position when we come back.
better run to Men's Warehouse. Suits are on sale, including designer brands and big and tall. Buy one and get a second suit for just $100. You're gonna like the way you look, I guarantee it.
On DVD and Blu-ray today.
We don't have to fight them.
Whoa. One of the biggest adventures of the year.
You're crazy.
I like that.
Breathes fire.
Oh, there go my undies.
You can get the all-new adventure in the Dragon Double DVD pack today. Ready PG.
HGDNet Halloween. Race to Hell. With the premiere of
Avenged Sevenfold.
Featuring Monsters of Metal.
Judas Priest. Megadeth.
It's HGDNet's Heavy Metal Halloween. Halloween night at 8. Only HGDNet.
This November, HGDNet Sunday Concerts delivers a star-studded audio avalanche.
Steve Miller Band.
Cheap Trick.
And
Hit on a Run.
John Anderson and the Contemporary Youth Orchestra.
HGDNet Sunday Concerts this November.
Let's get it! Enough!
Travel the globe, master the styles. The world of MMA has never been bigger. Rated T for Teen. EA Sports. It's in a game.
FanHouse.com. Go beyond the scores and stats. Get the story behind the story from an all-star cast of writers who tell it like it is. Your sports live here. So step inside FanHouse.com.
The United Football League on HDNet is presented by Wilson. By Custom Bite, the only off-the-shelf true custom-fit mouth guard. As a look at that new Amway Center, the home of the Orlando Magic downtown, a beautiful facility. And now we come over to the venerable Citrus Bowl. It's 10-9 starting the fourth quarter. And Florida is kicking it away, and Ken Parrish with his eighth punt. No, they snap it short. Fourth, they needed two. What a gamble there. Did they get it? It looks like it's going to be very close. They snapped it to Gessner, the up back. They needed fourth and two, and I don't know if they got it.
He didn't get it.
You talk about putting everything, all the cards on the table. Jay Gruden with a huge gamble to start the fourth quarter. That was a fourth and two at their own 22.
What he's trying to do is just start some kind of spark. But even, the worst part about this whole thing is that if you look at the kicker didn't fake. He didn't do anything. I blame the kicker. I mean, it's good defense, granted. But I'm going to tell you something. The kicker didn't do a thing to fool the defense.
That was Joe West, 19, that was leading the way for the tackle. So look at this now. Culpepper has a great position here. First and 10 at the 23. He hands to Corey Ross, who gets inside the 20. This is going to be a gamble that they're going to talk about for a long time if it blows up in their face. Let's check in with Paul Crane.
Kenny, the fake punt was an audible called by the special teams group. Coach Gruden told me that they thought they saw something, but it didn't work. So he's a little concerned about that. An update on Brooks Bollinger. Coach Gruden said his neck was a little tight from that injury. It was his decision. He may or may not let Bollinger come back in the game.
Well, that sounds like everybody's covering their base there on who was at fault. Amy on a reverse gets inside the 15 to about the 14. It ain't my fault. They called it upstairs. Well, that's a heck of a call, isn't it? On fourth and two when you're back that deep in your own territory.
I'd like to know who made the audible call. It had to be made by a player on the field that did it. But my problem was that the punter just didn't do anything. And that's Parrish. I mean, you've got to fake like you're getting the ball. Do something to try to hold somebody there.
You wonder if he was in on the play. Third and two, down to the 15. Ross right up the middle and gets the first down just outside the 10-yard line. Corey Ross going to work.
I'll tell you what, that was a huge gamble. Now, just take a look at this offensive line. They're in the red zone position, and they're pulling and doing the things that they need to do. This is a pretty good football team, but you got them down there now. That's Robertson, number 62, was a right guard that pulled and got a really good block in the hole.
First and 10, ball just outside the 10, right around 11. They can get a first down without getting a touchdown. Ross carries on the left side. Sacramento went from best in the league last week in the red zone to worst after a couple of fumbles in the red zone. They're 1-for-2 tonight, and that means on the season they've been there 12 times and they've been able to come away with 9 scores.
We have another timeout and an injured player. This is Sacramento. And that's Lentz, the backup center.
Who came in when Mike Mabry, the starting center, was injured and had to go to the sideline. So while they check on the injured player, Sacramento threatening. They're down by 1.
Sure, we pick up the zone blitz. Weak side linebacker, who's got him? Who's got the Sam linebacker when he comes?
We got to pick this up now. Here we go. Flank right. F fly.
The United Football League. If you like great football, you'll love the UFL.
What pisses you off?
The hardest words are fighting words.
When I don't get my workout in, that pisses me off.
What prepared you for this kind of combat sport?
The way I grew up, being picked on a lot when I was younger.
Can you go into a fight and not hate your opponent?
I know I gotta do what I have to do. He's gonna try to hurt me.
You still are doing those spinning back kicks. How the hell do you do that?
Fighting Words with Mike Straka. Tomorrow at 8:30 on HDNet.
You live and learn. You kick and you punch, you feel the pain.
A tournament with a generation of tradition is adding a new chapter and continues the journey for a new champion. K1 World Max 70 kilograms, Final 16. One will stand alone.
The time for talk is Ivan.
On the channel with more MMA events than any other network. Don't miss a minute of action. HDNet Fights. K1 World Max 70 kilograms, Final 16. Tomorrow at 10 Eastern on HDNet. Your home for MMA.
And back here in Florida, the Tuskers leading at 10-9. It's been a long time since Florida has scored. They threatened once in the second half and then fumbled it away inside the 10. And then a huge gamble on 4th-and-2 deep in their own territory. They went for it, faking a punt, snapping it short, and that gave Sacramento great field position. And that brings us to where we are now. 2nd-and-7, the ball on the 8. Mike Mabry is back in, the starting center returning as his backup, Matt Lentz, was injured. Mabry, former star in Central Florida, came just after Dante Culpepper's great career. That's the tandem there now on 2nd-and-7 from the 8. Culpepper dishes it. Ross gets inside the 5. Dacus comes up to make the tackle.
I'm gonna tell you, this play is huge for Florida. They have to stop. Well, you're seeing Ross here now, and he just goes down. He sees Schlegel, number 51, standing in the hole, and he really does a smart thing. He gets to the ground.
Wenzer comes in. He's in the slot now. He's shot by himself on the left side. Biddle moves into the slot on the right. 3rd-and-4 at the 5. Culpepper rolling. Still rolling, looking, and he's going to be forced out of bounds. Salve was there to force him out. And
Salve gets a sack.
Salve coming up with a big play, was injured earlier, went out. He comes in and picks up his first sack of the season. And Dante Culpepper will go to the sideline and hope that the kicking team can come through as Scotia, who had it blocked earlier, deflected by Castilla, comes in to kick a 27-yarder. Out of the hold of the punter, Malone. Scotia puts it through his fifth field goal of the season. And for the first time, Sacramento takes the lead. A big gamble for Florida. Backfires. Sacramento's in front.
This stuff is good.
Breaking open the crust, it was like a treasure.
I think it's kind of the zest to it.
Have you tried this?
I love them. This is really good.
That's good.
This is the real deal. This is the stuff that we eat.
I absolutely love Crunch and Munch.
My whole family loves Hebrew National.
I love Peter Pan.
I absolutely
love. They love it.
My son's Florida.
I love.
I love.
My kids love.
Oh, I love.
I love.
My family
loves.
I love.
This November, HDNet Fights is the place to be for MMA's biggest events. First, the world's elite takes center stage, and only one will stand victorious. Sengoku Raiden Championship 15. Plus, MMA vets and Los Angeles superstars look to leave their mark. Maximum Fighting Championship, Breaking Point. Then, the world's most feared strikers prepare for battle. K1 World Max 2010. Every Friday in November on HDNet, your home for MMA.
Hi, I'm Kenny Rice.
And I'm Boss Rutten.
Be sure to join us each week for Inside MMA, bringing you a knockout panel of all-star fighters.
And as always, we take you places where only our cameras can go, and we give you news and highlights you won't find anywhere else.
Nowhere else. Inside MMA, tomorrow night at 9 Eastern, only on HDNet, your
home for MMA.
This is Dante Cooper, quarterback of the Sacramento Mountain Lions, and you're watching UFL on HDNet.
There's Dante Culpepper, his team in front for the first time tonight. It's going back to just over a minute and a half to go in the first quarter, the last time that the Tuskers scored. They jumped out to a 10-0 lead, and Sacramento with the key play being that third down when they were backed up at their own three. They got a first down. Culpepper going to Windsor. That led to a 97-yard drive. Then they got a safety in this second half, and then took advantage of a fake punt on fourth and two back around the 22 of Florida. And that's where we are now. Escacia, who just kicked the field goal to put his team in front, boots it away. And Kaysen moves up at the 10, 20, 25. Nice run. Gets up to around the 36-yard line. That's Dominic Rhodes with the return.
There was nothing good about a fake punt. Can I tell you that? Now here comes Kaysen. I mean, this is really good blocking.
That's Rhodes, actually, Paul. Rhodes picking up 26 yards on that. And we haven't seen much of Rhodes in this second half.
No, but he's upset. He thought he should have scored on the play. One more block, he might have. But I'm just saying, but the fake punt, I mean, there's in your territory down inside your 20-yard line, there's just nothing good happens.
Negative 4 yards for Rhodes this half. He stays in and gets jammed up and brought down right at the line of scrimmage by Schaible. A.J. Schaible making that stop.
Schaible is now, he was a tackle. He's playing the right defensive end. And what I really like about Sacramento, watch how Schaible stays home. He's the right defensive end. Look at, they're trying to block him down. He goes back to the outside, and he just waits for Dominic Rhodes to get there and makes the tackle for no gain, actually.
Second and 10, it remains. Ball at the 36. Grayson, the quarterback, flips it over the middle and gets his completion. That is the first one of the night for Grayson. As he hits Rhodes out of the backfield.
But just take a look at this. I mean, this is just a nice pass right to Dominic Rhodes. He knows he's open in front of the linebackers. Now, linebacker's Marino, number 57. He's played off about 10 yards. They pick up 8 on the play. It's a good call.
Grayson coming in. Bollinger on the sidelines. Complained of a sore neck. And it was a rough night for Brooks Bollinger. So Chris Grayson, a star in arena football, getting his chance right now. He's under pressure. He's spinning around, and he's going down. Schaible was there. A.J. Schaible in there along with Antoine Burton, both putting the pressure on Grayson and bringing up a fourth down.
Well, Grayson had nowhere to throw the football. And you just say, boy, you don't need to take a sack. that's okay. You're at the 37, 38-yard line. There's still almost 10 minutes to go in the ball game. Just don't do something stupid and throw it into the defense's hands. I think he did the right thing.
Ken Parrish will kick a record punt. No matter how far it goes, it's already set a record for combined punts in a UFL game. Rolls down around the 26-yard line, and that's where they will take over. Sacramento leading in the fourth. They have the ball after that 36-yard punt when we come back.
Guys Night In is taking Thursdays off.
For once, we're going to do something wholesome.
Sounds like it sucks.
This is messed up, okay?
Here's the problem. You don't have our friends nudity and our friend alcohol.
But don't stress. You can still watch us on Saturday nights.
It's heaven. My heart's going right now thinking about it.
Catch fresh new episodes November 4th.
Do you see how it works? It's nice.
Guys Night In returns Thursday, November 4th.
The only thing weird in my mind is that date.
Only on HD Net.
Hey guys, Kara Zavaleta here, your host of HDNet's original series, Get Out, part of HDNet's Guys Night In.
If you want it, come get it. Come get it.
So it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun.
Every Thursday and Saturday night, we offer the craziest and most hilarious programming you will ever see on television.
We love the competition. We love sweat. We love the party.
Everything from gorgeous bathing beauties to some of the most hilarious stories from around the world.
What's wrong? Why are you grabbing your butt?
Mom, if you're watching this, please don't get upset.
Hi, Mom.
And let's not forget, the night ends with unrated programming that is hot, hot, and oh so hot, baby.
There's a double rainbow.
It's beautiful.
It's beautiful. It's a double rainbow.
High five up here.
Yeah, she's a delicious lady.
It's time to do it.
So join me, Kara Zavaleta, every Thursday and Saturday night on HDNet's Guys Night In. Sure to be one hell of a good time.
9:37 to go here in the fourth quarter. You gotta love cheerleaders, whether their team's ahead or behind, they're cheering. And yeah, their team's behind. 12-10 right now. Sacramento is leading. Danny Green was talking. They want to win this game so badly. They need to for many reasons, but also they have two of their three remaining games at home. They play at Hartford. And then they close out with Omaha on the friendly confines out there of Hornet Stadium, where they've had 20,000 and 19,000 in their first two games. They'd like to get back there with the win. Culpepper, first down, going long, and it's just out of reach for Tate Biddle. Biddle had a step on his man, and it was almost there.
Boy, I'll tell you what, Tate Biddle is just, he's sending someone else in now because he did that dash, and it's been a long game for these guys. But this ball, look at him launch. Dante Culpepper, look at this throw. I mean, when I saw Biddle, he was behind a defensive back, and
Jerome
it looked
Carter.
Like he had it.
He had Jerome Carter by about a step here, it looks like, or two steps here, Paul.
Oh, I mean, this ball was about a foot and a half too long. What a throw.
He's still got a cannon, hasn't he,
Culpepper? Yeah, he does. Yeah, he does.
Of course, that knee injury 5 years ago did slow him down a bit in the running game, but we see he can still move, and no stop at all in that big arm of his on second and 10. Rolls out to the left, flips it to Lowry. Lowry, a little hop to up to about the 32-yard line, triple there to make the hit on him.
Boy, I saw the defensive lineman really made a nice play because it was a fake toss by Dante Culpepper, and he rolled out, and Save just stayed where he was supposed to, and then he threw the ball to Lowry, but there really was about 6 or 7 yard gain on the play. But this thing could have gone a long way if it wasn't for Save, because Culpepper had to get rid of it.
They pick up six, it's third and four at the 31. Sacramento 7 for 17 on third down. That's Ross, top of your screen. Empty backfield now. Culpepper sets up, throws, intercepted. Intercepted by Florida. And going down inside the five, a huge play for Tony Taylor, the backup middle linebacker. How about Tony Taylor? Played briefly with the Falcons, the former University of Georgia star.
This is a throw that Dante Culpepper did not read the defense, because he threw the ball where there were four white shirts, and Tony Taylor was the guy that got it. What? Look at the guys out here. There's only one white shirt. Tony Taylor was there, and what a beautiful interception.
What a tackle by Culpepper inside the five there. You see Taylor played at the University of Georgia, where his teammates were Odell Thurman and Arnold Harrison, and now they're all three together on this team. And he returns that back 25 yards, and it's first and goal. Rhodes in the backfield. He's taken one to the house. Waiting for the signal. It's number two tonight for Rhodes. His second touchdown of the evening. And Dominic Rhodes has Florida back in front after the Tony Taylor interception put him in beautiful field position.
Well, Dominic Rhodes, you get him near the goal line, and man, I'm telling you, this guy finds it. Watch Dominic Rhodes. He's just following his offensive line up in through the hole, and he gets down lower than they can get and dives for the end zone. Just remember, the ball just has to touch that white line, and it's touchdown.
Novak puts it through. Florida comes storming back, leading it 17-12. Tony Taylor, number 50, the star right now. Former Georgia star, played briefly with the Falcons for a couple of seasons, makes the interception of Dante Culpepper's pass and takes it inside the five, and that set it up for the touchdown that you just saw by Rhodes.
Well, with Dominic Rhodes gets in for the score right here, but I'll tell you what, Dante Culpepper looked to his left like he was looking him off, but Tony Taylor never moved. He just went back to the outside. He knew he had the tight end. He went right to the outside, but there were three or four black shirts there when Culpepper threw the ball. He just didn't look. He just went back, believed that it was open, and threw it.
Seventh time this season that Culpepper has been intercepted. And Novak will kick it away with 8:27 to go. Wood stands back deep. Remember the first time these teams met in September before 20,000 at the Hornets Nest there, Hornets Stadium, where Sacramento calls home. They rallied with 17 points in the fourth quarter to overcome a double-figure deficit and win. Woods at the six. 20. And that's about as far as he will get. 22 yards on the return. Triple upends him.
You know, when you look at these returns, Kenny, you just can't form a wall like you used to be able to. You can only have two men really get together. And they really didn't get together. So it's up to the runner. If these guys would attack, each guy pick a guy and try to put them on the ground. But as you look at this whole screen, you don't see one person on the ground. Nobody was knocked down.
They'll start at the 29, first and 10. It's a tight end, Lowry, moving. Culpepper back, looks over to Ross, pressure on, Culpepper moving, and firing it deep down the sideline, complete to Tay Biddle. He hits Biddle. Jones right there to finally bring him down, and that was vintage Culpepper, although there is a flag back at around the 40. 47 yards on that pass. We'll see if it stands up.
Illegal man downfield. Well, you know, that's not surprising, but I'm going to tell you what Dante Culpepper does here. You talk about a heads-up play. You know, it was supposed to be a screen to the left, and Florida read it absolutely perfectly. Watch this. He's going to throw the ball left. Now that the screen is covered, he's going to get sacked, but he rolls out to the right. There's an offensive lineman downfield. But look at this ball on the run that he throws to Tay Biddle. It's a perfect strike. All right, now take a look at the offensive lineman. There they are. There's number 60. Spanos is number, he's downfield, way downfield. There's actually three guys on the offense downfield.
Eighth penalty tonight for Sacramento.
What a throw.
105 yards. Penalized tonight. So now first and 15 at the 24. Shoots this one out on the flat, and Maxwell does a nice job to scoop it off the top of the grass, or the top of the turf as it is now.
That's one of those deals where Maxwell has to go down and get the ball, and it's a wonderful catch. But then he's thinking, well, you know, I caught it, and I've got no place to go except get hammered. which he does. You're going to throw that play. You've got to throw that ball into the receiver's hands. So he has a chance to make one move. If he can make one move, he's in the secondary.
A yard after all that. Biddle back in. Out to the right. Second and 14 at the 25. Culpepper sets up. Looks. Throws it over the middle. Has his completion to Lowry, the tight end. He's going to be close to the first down.
He's going to be about a half a yard or maybe a yard short of the first down. And it's third down and one. But just look at the patience of Culpepper. He was trying to catch Biddle going across the middle, but Biddle really never cleared their linebackers. So he had to pull up and throw the ball to Lowry.
13 on that third and one. Culpepper will keep it, take it right over and get it up to the 40, and it appears a first down.
Culpepper is 6'4", 260 pounds. You need a half yard.
Do the math.
Yeah. It doesn't take a genius for that one. They have to score a touchdown here, folks. They have three timeouts remaining. We're getting down to 6 minutes. They're not running out of time. Just be patient. You got a lot of time in this ball game.
They're staying with the no huddle. We heard Dennis Green tell Ron Kruk at halftime. They felt comfortable with that. Culpepper can keep his rhythm going this way. He sets up. He fires it over the middle at midfield. He has a completion to Rod Windsor, catching it in front of the linebacker, Tony Taylor, and a first down. And another first down grab by Windsor.
You know, Windsor worked hard all this week to get himself ready to play. And the guy said, I may play spottingly, but I'll tell you what, when he's been in the ball game, he deserves attention.
First and 10 at midfield. Culpepper dumps it out to Ross, up and it falls forward, gets about 7 on that. And that was Nate Salley, one of the newcomers to the secondary, former star at Ohio State and played with the Carolina Panthers, making the hit on Ross.
And this is all about patience, Kenny. It's all about patience. And Culpepper is patient.
Ninth catch for Ross. They pick up 7. It's 2nd and 3 at the 43. Oh, rough going for Amy. Held up and knocked down, shaken up. That was Tribble making the shot on Otis Amy.
I'll tell you what.
That was some hard yardage there.
Oh, man. Tribble just sees Otis Amy being held up to the outside. This is a great play by the secondary, the entire secondary.
That was Sally there.
Castile was there. And then Tribble comes in and just does the finishing touches. Watch this. Castile's got him up, and here comes the shot. Bang, and that's legal. There will be a headache in the morning.
Amy, former star at Sacramento State, playing in the hometown, has been one of the key receivers this year. Coming into this game was second, actually, among the receiving core, with Corey Ross obviously leading everyone coming out of the backfield, but among the receivers, he was second behind Windsor in most catches. There you look at DeJuan Tribble, who has moved into the starting lineup. They've been moving guys around because of injuries. His help to the sideline is Otis Amy. And doing some medical reports here, Chuck Wera, the outstanding end who has picked up another sack tonight, giving him 3.5 on the season. He is out now for Florida, we understand. Not likely to return. Also for Florida, it is Anthony Schlegel, a dislocated shoulder. He's gone for the night. His backup, Tony Taylor, at middle linebacker, making a defensive gem with that interception to run it down and eventually lead to the Rhodes touchdown to put Florida back in front.
One of the things, the problem for Florida now is that you've got two middle linebackers, your starter, and now your second starter, Schlegel, hurt, and you only have one middle linebacker to play, and that's Tony Taylor.
Third and one at the 41. Again, what do you do? How about the 6'5", 260-pound guy? And Culpepper lunging forward to get yet another first down. And there you see working on the sideline with receiver Otis Amy.
I'm
He certainly took a hard hit.
We're getting down to 4 minutes. Remember now that Sacramento, they have three timeouts. They've got virtually all day. And if you're going to throw it, don't be afraid to throw it over the middle.
You got a great guy in there leading the situation. Dante Culpepper already with one come-from-behind drive for victory this year against Florida. Flips it over the backfield to Ross, and Ross picks up the first down. Taylor moves in to make the hit. Five straight now completions for Culpepper.
The one thing we said about him not being impatient, just take a look at Culpepper. Why not? I'll give it to Ross. He's the leading receiver. He's also the leading rusher. He does everything for our football team. They are now letting him come out of the backfield, and nobody's really covering him. You've got a brand new middle linebacker in the ball game in Tony Taylor. They've got all day, so they're patient. They're going to have to come up and do something with Ross.
10 catches, 88 yards tonight for Ross. First and 10, ball down to the 28. On the ground this time is Ross. And that's when Ross seems, that's what he did last week, Paul. You make a catch, then come back, rip off about 3 or 4 yards, get you in good position for second down.
We looked at this guy last week, and I watch him again this week. Does he ever get tired?
No, apparently not.
He's got to be in terrific shape, this guy.
He's caught 10 passes tonight. He's had 21 carries on the evening. He picks up 7 there, second and 3. The ball down to the 23. 2:40 to go in this game. Ross outside the 20 to the 15, where he steps out of bounds and Castile moves up.
He's going to get a break here. They're going to bring in John David Washington. Just, you know, and I guarantee you he's not going to be out for very long. Watch Ross. Watch his footwork to get back to the outside. He sees the outside, take as much as you can possibly get, and then get out of bounds.
Ross picks it 6 on that. This drive started back at the 29. This is the 11th play of the drive. It's first and 10, ball at the 14. John David Washington now in the lone setback. Culpepper audible. Steps back and throws it way out of bounds.
Well, he had no one to throw the ball to, and you know, he said, okay, I know, be patient, I know. It's only first down, got plenty of time.
Got a couple more here.
Don't yell at
me. Actually, in this case, 3 more.
That's right, don't yell at me. The guy he was looking for in that last play, I don't know if he was, he threw it over his head, was Nate Lowry, the tight end.
Second and 10 at the 14. Culpepper looks over to Biddle, now flips it out there to him. And Biddle will get maybe a yard, fooling very few on that. That was Kewan Ratcliffe. They bring him in usually as the nickelback, and he stays right there with it, the former University of Florida star making the tackle.
Well, Culpepper was actually looking for the end zone to throw it in the corner of the end zone. And the wide receiver on that side couldn't get open. So Biddle was just sitting there waiting. He was the outlet receiver.
Third and 8, ball at the 12. 2:23 to go in this game. And Windsor is back in the lineup. He has been the key man all season long and has 2 big third down catches tonight. Culpepper dropping back, looking, firing it out to Lowry in the flat, and he is brought down immediately.
They're going to go down to the 2-minute warning here, and this is where Sacramento's really got to make a big choice. They need a touchdown. It's fourth down. It's at the 2-minute warning. You better come up with the best play you had in your whole game plan.
Dante Culpepper. Does he have a big play before the home crowd? Coming up.
Manhouse.com. Go beyond the scores and stats. Get the story behind the story from an all-star cast of writers who tell it like it is. Your sports live here. So step inside Manhouse.com.
HDNet Halloween. Race to Hell with the premiere of
Avenged Sevenfold.
Featuring Monsters of Metal,
Judas Priest, Megadeth, and Korn.
It's HDNX Heavy Metal Halloween. Halloween Night at 8. Only HDNet. HDNet Sunday Concerts brings the biggest events in music right to your living room.
The Rolling Stones. Green Day. Welcome to paradise. Foreigner. Check and see. And My Chemical Romance.
HDNet Sunday Concerts. Live life loud.
You better run to Men's Warehouse. Suits are on sale, including designer brands and big and tall. Buy one and get a second suit for just $100. You're going to like the way you look. I guarantee it.
Welcome back to Florida. Tuskers leading at 17-12 at the two-minute warning. Kenny Rice, Paul McGuire, Ron Kruk, Paul Crane on the sideline. This is the ball game. The 14th play of this drive coming up. And it's fourth and five. The ball at the 9-yard line.
And before the half, they had another 14 play drive that ended with a touchdown, and they threw it to Maxwell out in the corner. This, I'm not kidding, you go to the sideline and you say, I want your best play.
Because this is
a 9-yard line, and this is it.
Dante Culpepper, 12 years ago, he shined on this field as the star quarterback for Central Florida. Homecoming tonight started off a little rough, but it's picked up for he and the Mountain Lions. And here it is. Fourth and five. Culpepper, keep it. Culpepper, touchdown! Dante Culpepper has Sacramento in front. Shades of old there, Paul. That looked like Central Florida days a dozen years ago.
I'll tell you, it was wonderful because everybody was in coverage. The defensive line figured, we've got to get back to Culpepper. And this was a called play. I said, your best play, what put in the hands of the guy that's been making plays all night long, Dante Culpepper.
Culpepper right down the middle, capping a 14-play drive. And now they will go for two, leading at 18-17.
I mean, what a brilliant call. I mean, it really was.
What a night has been for Culpepper. 31 for 49, 259 yards. He's thrown for a touchdown.
This was
run. And he tucks and goes here.
Kenny, this was run all the way. If you watch him, he was not looking really at a receiver. He was kind of looking off the lineman more than he was anybody else because he already read the defense that they were all back in coverage. But when you looked at his eyes, it was run from the time he got the ball.
Dante Culpepper, we've seen him on a 97-yard drive that got his team right back in it before the end of the first half. And this one, 14-play, 71-yard drive, eating up almost 6.5 minutes of clock. And he takes it in for his first rushing touchdown this season.
You think is it the stadium? Or is it?
It's
13-1 in the stadium?
He had only one loss when he was here at Central Florida, when he was the guy putting Central Florida on the map. And people were saying, hey, they have another team that's pretty good down there in addition to Florida State and Florida and Miami and all that power they have in college ranks. And there's a guy from Ocala named Culpepper leading them. Here he's trying for two. He's put his team in front now. Culpepper looking, throwing it over the head. Good coverage over the head of Joe West. Couldn't get that, but he's running for the score that has Sacramento in front. Can Florida respond with a minute 55 to go?
You ready?
Yeah.
No. Wait. Now if I'm gonna.
Oh. Oh. Thank you.
Man. Do me.
Oh.
I just puked in my mouth.
Oh,
I just puked in my mouth. Come on, give it to me.
Oh. Oh. OMG.
Wow. Ooh. You good?
We're good. Oh.
Looks like we're gonna be here all season.
Can't get enough football?
Touchdown!
the United Football League. If you like great football, you'll love the UFL.
On an all-new episode of Drinking Made Easy, Zane and the boys make drinking easy in Dallas. First, Zane gets the wrong end of a buffalo.
You think this guy was grazing out in a field and said, hey, I'd love it if my ass was displayed in a bar.
Then kicks it like a cowboy. And Steve feels the wrath of 15 pounds of meat and potatoes.
Have my friends, puking made easy.
Drinking Made Easy in Dallas. All new episode Wednesday at 8:30 Eastern on HDNet.
Inside the 10, the 5, touchdown!
The first meeting was all Vegas.
There's nothing better than winning. Nothing better.
Omaha's dream season far from over.
We want to be that last team standing.
The push for postseason is on. Every game matters.
We're a physical team, and we're in good shape.
Every team is capable. Every single week is critical.
The UFL on HDNet, Las Vegas and Omaha. Coverage begins live next Thursday night, 7:30 Eastern, only on HDNet.
The United Football League on HDNet is presented by Men's Warehouse, the official men's retail clothing store of the United Football League. Men's Warehouse, you're going to like the way you look. By AOL Fanhouse. For more information on the United Football League, go to fanhouse.com. By Progressive Insurance, making it easy to shop for car insurance. Dante Culpepper taking it in to put the Mountain Lions up. Florida trying now with a minute 55 to go. Let's go to Ron.
Fourth and 5 from the 9. You call a timeout. Did you call your own number on that one? Well, we had to play, you know, somewhere in the repertoire. We just dug deep and found it. I'm glad they had the confidence in me to call it. We made it happen. We executed it. The offensive line did a great job. Receivers did a great job pushing off the line. I just did what I had to do and got in. Very good. Thanks, Dante. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Ron. Big run for Culpepper. Is that the one that's going to hold up? Scaccia will kick it off. Standing back is Dominic Rhodes. He has 2 touchdowns tonight. And this time, unlike the first game when the Mountain Lions had to rally in the fourth quarter, the Tuskers will have to do so now. Rhodes, nice run, gets across the 30. Holmes makes the hit on him. That's Lindy Holmes, one of the recent additions here to this secondary, along with McCauley and a couple of other newcomers here on defense. A 31-yard return for Rhodes. Good field position out to the 32 for Chris Greissen, who begins his 4th series tonight. And remember, they have in Nick Novak, the man who's kicked a 54-yard field goal this season. That was a league record that Scaccia eventually tied. 1st and 10 at the 32. Rhodes alone set by Greissen, steps back, throws it, and it's intercepted by McCauley. Marcus McCauley picks it off, and that is the ball game. Wow, what a turnover there. McCauley reaching up. He just joined the team this week, the former Minnesota Viking who grew up in Sacramento, played at Cordova High School and then Fresno State.
This has come from not playing much. Watch what he tries to do with Greissen with his ball. He tries to fit it in over a corner instead of throwing it. You got to throw the ball so that the defense, they don't have a chance. Look at this ball. I mean, it is just up in the air. It's floating.
So they're cheering back at Cordova High School in Sacramento and at Fresno State as well. The 3rd turnover tonight for Florida. 1st interception from Greissen. And what a victory this is going to be for Culpepper and company. There's McCauley celebrating his interception. Hand off to Ross. And Ross will find his way down close to the 25. The Tuskers with 2 timeouts left. They're going to use one of them. Stopping the clock with 1:33 to go.
Hey, let me tell you something, man. This. It's for fucking Robert Bourne.
You heard the "this is for Robert Bourne" rally cry there. Bourne broke his leg last week, out for the season. So they brought in Marcus McCauley. They also brought in Lindy Holmes, Terrell Mays, and Kelly Malvo alternating at the cornerback. And of course, they've got one of the best strong safeties in the whole league in Andrew Zendejo. We've seen him with an interception tonight as well as recovering a fumble.
You know, the amazing part about it is you
bring in all these guys that really haven't played. They're learning a system. Now you say, okay, well, you can learn defense. No, you can't. I mean, everything's called. Everybody has to be in a place. These guys are playing extremely well.
Ross dancing around, goes down, and now the Tuskers will use their last timeout with 1:28 to go.
And just remember now, they got a field goal kicker that can kick, that has kicked a 54-yard field goal.
Fabricio Scaccia. You see Gryson there, he was in for four plays tonight, four series rather, because setting out this second half is Brooks Bollinger, who had some neck problems, and Paul Crane gives his report. He's getting a little stiff in the back perhaps. Groot said that's enough. Now bringing in Gryson as the backup. And if this holds up, what a win it's going to be for Sacramento. I mean, it's now or never time. They came in here 1-3, one more loss, and they're for certain gone from the playoff picture. And here they are about to pull an upset on the road on 3rd and 4th to 24, 1:28 to go. Straight up the middle, Corey Ross.
Now they'll let this baby go down, all the way down. They can run off 36 seconds, so it'll take it about 40 seconds, 45 seconds by the time that Florida will get the ball. But do you kick a field goal here?
That's what I was going to ask.
Because they already blocked one of yours.
Castilla already has got a hand on it. Castillo blocked one.
And Culpepper's looking at this thing saying, you know what, it's 4th and 1. I'm 6'4", I weigh 260. I've already picked up 2 first downs and then a touchdown.
Why not?
Why not?
Well, I'll tell you the why not. I believe you got to kick it. I really do.
This will be a 30-second timeout.
I got to believe you got to kick it. First of all, because it puts you up 4.
Well, they took the timeout to figure it out. There's a couple of guys who's been through a few things. Dennis Green on the left talking to Dante Culpepper.
You know, look at Dante shaking his head. Well, you know, give it to me. Let me take it off.
You know, I've only lost once on this field, coach, or in this stadium. New surface since he played here, but 13-1 as a collegian. But Scaccia is coming on. Fabricio Scaccia.
I'll tell you, this year, this is the biggest kick he's going to make this year, right here, I think. Because it puts him up 4, and he knows he's got to get it out. Because remember, if he doesn't make this thing, Florida gets the ball at the 30-yard line coming out.
It's a 39-yard kick. Gruden hoping they still have a shot. Snap's good. Kick is up. It is good. Fabricio Scaccia, a member of the Minor League Football Hall of Fame. He did not play collegiate ball because he was already playing semi-pro ball. And he's a bit of a legend among the old semi-pro circles. And there he boots that one through, Paul. And that might, you're right, be the biggest kick so far. It now means it's a touchdown game. The Tuskers have to have a touchdown. Trailing by 4 with 33 seconds and no timeouts remaining.
Now that's the big problem, and you've got a quarterback that really has not played this year, and you saw in the last series, and Gryson, you're not down on the guy. There's things that you have to do when you get in a ball game when you're trying to get back to the lead, and that's it. You've got to be really precise with your passes. You can't hang them up in the air and give the defense a chance to go get them.
Well, Scaccia, who put the field goal through to make it a 4-point game. Now we'll kick off to Dominic Rhodes. You know, what a great game for the second straight week by Sacramento's defense. In essence, keeping the offense out of the end zone. I know Rhodes had that short rushing touchdown, but that was set up by a miscue. It was set up by a defensive play. But for the most part, they have shut down Florida's offense since back in the first quarter when they jumped out to a 10-0 lead.
It was, 1:32?
Yeah.
When they scored the touchdown, and the offense has done nothing since. Well, they got in the red zone one time
and fumbled
the football. But the defense has played both well for both of these teams.
And Rhodes had his second touchdown here, set up by a great defensive play. Rhodes taking a couple deep in the end zone, gets it across the 25. Ball squirts loose, and yes, it is Zendejo right on top of it. Andrew Zendejo, defensive player of the game, probably.
Of the year.
he's turned in a heck of a performance. And we say that watching Isaiah Trufant last week, a couple of weeks ago for Vegas, how good he has played. But here's Rhodes, and this just sort of caps it off for Florida, doesn't it?
Well, yeah, and Rhodes is just trying to get as far as he possibly can. And this ball does come out. They strip it out in 34. You know, you say, here's a football player that's really aware of what's going on in the field. I mean, you know he works at it. He said, you know, all I'm doing is the things that they told me to do. We're playing the defense. I'm not doing anything spectacular. I'm just doing what I'm supposed to be doing. And he's smiling.
And Lindy Holmes, one of those newly acquired defensive guys in the secondary, he's the one that helped knock it loose. And that is the game. Dante Culpepper lost only one time here as a collegian at Central Florida. He was 13-1. He comes back for the first time as a pro and leaves 1-0. Culpepper keeping it, running 10 yards for the winning touchdown. And a huge game for the Mountain Lions. Must-win situation, they get it. Now they go home to play Hartford. They have two of their next three at home. They go to 2-3, and now you have to wonder about Florida. They have two of their final three left at home, including two games against Omaha, but they drop to 2-3, and they're gonna face must-time situation. Let's go down to Ron with the happy homecoming guy, I would imagine, Dante Culpepper.
Very happy. He's congratulating and saying hello to a lot of his friends. Dante, you improved to 14-1 in this stadium. You scored the game-winning touchdown. Could you ask for a better homecoming?
Oh, man, it was great. You know, it was luckily, you know, we were able to have the opportunity to win it there at the end. But, man, it's just a great feeling. I'm just going to enjoy it. And I love it here in Orlando.
You should. The offensive line gave you all night to pass. The running game got going as well. Talk about the Hogs up front.
Well, I'll tell you what, I can't give those guys enough credit. You know, they take a lot of slack for this or that, but I'll tell you what, tonight, they just kept fighting, they dug it out, and I mean, that's what you want. You want a group of guys up front that's gonna pour their heart out for you, and they did it tonight.
Dante, you improved to 2-3 overall, and two of your next three games are at home. Do you guys feel you're right back in the playoff hunt?
Well, I'll tell you what, you gotta win the second before you can win the third one. So that was our goal, to come get this one. Now we just gotta get back in California, regroup, get ready for next week.
All right, Dante, enjoy this victory.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Paul and Kenny, back upstairs.